en paz, ya. Yo quiero que tú bailes, dale sin parar. Todo mundo, hey, quiero vacilar. Shake it, and I'll throw it right back. Ooh, take it back to when nobody used to know me. Let's tell them I was just chilling with my homies. Now that we're popping, everybody is talking. This is for my day ones. Don't forget the ones that made ya. Deep south sweating out flavor. This is for my day ones. Show love. Ooh, take it back to when nobody used to know me. Like tell you I was just chilling with my homies. Now that we're popping, everybody is talking. This is for my day ones. Don't forget the ones that made ya. Deep south sweating out flavor. This is for my day ones. Day ones.
Oh, 아프리카 TV 콜로세움 라이브 ASL에 오신 것을 환영합니다.
그리고 What's up, everybody? Welcome to another day of the ASL. We're going to have a quick interview with our players. That'll take about 10 minutes, and then we'll be hopping into our matches as we get closer and closer to getting to the finals and declaring a champion here at our tournament.
Okay.
Sound good?
I'd rather just get into the games, but that's okay. Let's hear about the players.
If we must, Tasteless, I know you love this part.
This is my favorite part of the entire show. All right, let's meet our players. Hello, everybody.
안녕하세요.
안녕하세요.
Hello, Larva. He says hello.
제외하고 모든 ASL에 함께해 주셨고
Since the National Star League.
이번 시즌 10을 통해서 열 번째 시즌을 맞이하고
You had participated in every single ASL.
일단
Then took some time off. How are you feeling now that you're back?
되게 편안해지고 이제 어떻게
보면 I'd be getting more familiar with the stage and the studio here in Jamshil.
그만큼 또 안 좋아하지 않고 또 이제 열심히
and as things are becoming more familiar.
어제 방송을 통해서는 프로토스전에 살짝 좀
But I think I still need to not drop my guard. I need to focus in today.
하던데 네. 본인 16강 진출에는 문제 없는 거죠?
Yesterday on your stream you were struggling playing against Protoss. How are you feeling today? And will you advance to the round of 16?
Yeah, I mean 안 할 것 같아요. 자신 있기 때문에.
네. 네.
기대해 주셔도
You got to do your best.
네. 또
whenever you're playing. Especially in these offline matches where the pressure's on.
안녕하세요.
안녕하세요.
So I have high expectations for myself.
하게 되셨습니다. 경기장에 ASL 무대로 돌아오신 소감 어떠세요?
It's been a while to see you. How are you feeling today?
근데 저번에 ESTL 하다 보니까 그래도 조금은 덜 긴장.
Yeah, the last time. I was here playing the team league. But still, I do feel a little bit nervous today.
같이 경기를 했던 유영진 선수, 이몽규 선수 오늘도 같은 조에서 경기를 펼치게 됐더라고요.
Your very first ASL.
기억을 못 하고 계셨구나.
You were against Larvin your group. And now you're here facing him again. He says, "Oh, I didn't realize that."
근데 이제 그래도
What's going on in your mind when you're looking at the groups today?
만약에 올라간다면 잘하는 사람이랑 해서 이기고 올라가야 더 의미 있으니까.
네.
If I make it out of this group.
그럼 본인이 올라갈 거라는 자신은 좀 있으신가요?
I just need to play well.
네. 알겠습니다.
Are you confident you're going to make it out of your group? Yeah, sure. I guess I'm confident. 네, Let's go to you now, Stork. Hello.
1차 예선 경기를 통해서 또 이렇게 본선에 합류하게 되셨습니다. 네. 컨디션은 좀 어떠세요?
일단
So you managed to qualify.
Condition은
You're here on the main stage. How is your condition?
네, 이제 좀 게임이 안 돼서
I'd say my condition is good. However, recently my performance has been lackluster. Anyways, I've practiced
네,
very hard.
방송에서는 게임이 너무 안 돼가지고
Well, why don't you tell us a little bit about your preparation?
게임을 하면 자신감이 죽을 것 같아가지고 방송을 끄고 연습을 했는데 결과는 괜찮았고
네.
In a lot of my broadcasted matches, I haven't been able to play the games I want to play in tournaments. So I've had my stream turned off, and I think that might give me an edge here. And that way people can't study what his play is on stream. Last season you got to the round of 8. But I'm sure you want to get to you know, a new high point by getting to the semifinals. That's correct. I got to the quarterfinals. And this season, I really, really am aiming to get to the semifinals.
네, 기대하겠습니다. 유영진 선수와도
So hopefully I can bring some great results today. So you were eliminated in the round of 24 last season. How are you feeling today? Feels different. I think I've got better builds this season than last season. Recently your momentum's been really, really great. It seems like you've been grinding a lot online. And a lot of people have high expectations for you today. Yes, personally, I think for the past 30 years, I could say out of all my 30 years of gaming, this I'm in my prime right now. And I think I'm at the, my peak as a pro. Very exciting. Okay, we have some fan-submitted questions. Larva, this one's for you. Last season, you were defeated in, and went to the round of, excuse me, some of your performance has been disappointing recently. How are you going to perform today? I feel like I get this question every season. Anyways, I think I've overcome whatever slumps people thought I had in the past. Last season, I played against, excuse me, I didn't catch the name, but I had a good match there. Anyways, I can easily advance. There's a question about how he feels about the group. Yeah, look. In the past, I've been eliminated by Stork and other great players, but I think now it's different. And I'm going to be reversing that. This is not so much a question, but I think this person just wants a response from you. A fan just says, I really want to see Noob advance in the round of 16. How do you feel about that? Yeah, well, I really want to make it out of the round of 16. Or make it into the round of 16, excuse me. Anyways, I'm going to do my best to please my fans. A question for you now, Stork. Recently, it looks like you've succeeded in losing weight, but it does seem like your skills have gone down in that process. What's your take on that? Yeah, throughout my workouts, I learned a lot more about endurance. I think it's affected my gameplay, but I feel like I haven't played in enough offline matches since getting back into shape. Anyways, I'm pretty confident that I'll be playing better than before. I think she basically says, what's your hardest, biggest concern as far as an encounter today? He says, for me personally, Larva is the scariest. Whenever I encounter him online, I pretty much always lose.
So
hopefully I can get through this group. A question for you now, Rush. So this is your first individual league after you've been married. Being a married man, is that affect your preparation or your mentality at all? Well,
그냥 좋으시죠.
예, 그냥 뭐 결혼해서 좋고 그다음에 이제 좀 더 책임감을 가지고
Everything's good.
해 왔어요. 예.
이 조에서 그러고 보니까
I do have much more responsibilities at home.
싱글이시네요. 팬들의 응원을 더 많이 받으셔야 될 것 같아요.
But anyways, he just says he put a lot of prep and focus in.
않으세요, 갑자기?
아직
Noob, are you the only player who's single here?
자, 그럼 끝으로 네 분의 각오를 한 마디
Yeah, so far. I've been okay. I'm all right. Before we close the interview, any final words, Rush?
온라인에서 좀 잘한다는 소리를 그래 좀 듣고 있는데 여기서 못 올라간다면은 말짱
도움이라 생각합니다. We're getting a lot of support from fans online.
올라가도록 하겠습니다.
네, 김범수 선수.
If I don't make it out of this group.
준비한 거 실수 없이 잘해서
Anyways, he says he's going to do his best. Noob to you.
네, 임원규 선수 각오한 말씀 부탁드릴게요.
I'm just gonna try not to make any mistakes today.
열심히 해주시기 바랍니다. 네, 송병우 선수 마지막으로 한 마디.
I'll do my best.
열심히 해서
And you, Stork. I'll do my best too.
네, 네 선수 인터뷰 모두 감사드리고
show great performance.
고맙습니다.
All right, thank you very much, Artosis.
I want to tie myself God. In a burlap sack and jump in a river.
Jeez, oh, man. Can we just, we need to actually, because we've been doing this for so long, we need to, like, get the decision tree down for what the pro gamers say in their interviews.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, at this point, we can even know what the fans are going to ask, to be honest.
I see how everything works.
Your body weight changed. What's about that?
You're married. Does that mean you're going to play well?
You have a girlfriend
these
or you don't.
That,
it must impact
don't
you.
Don't correlate. Do they correlate?
No, who knows, according to the fans.
I have prepped hard, and I will show great games to my fans.
Yeah, what do you hope to do today? I hope I don't mess up.
I am feeling nervous, but I am also confident that I will win my games. Now let's do the post-match interview.
Who are you afraid
interview.
Of? The hard matchup.
The best player in my group is the one I fear the most.
Yeah.
Now let's do it after they've won. I would say I did not perform very well today.
I got a little bit lucky.
The games did not go as well as I had expected. But I am happy to advance 2-0 and go to the round of 16. If I had to grade my performance, I would give it a D+, despite being one of the 16 best players in the world at the hardest video game.
You know what I got to say is in esports, I mean, we keep seeing every company that's involved with esports hire these people that ran, like, you know, all sorts of sports things, right?
Yeah.
Like, oh, this is a football guy. Here's
bro
a guy
sports.
From, you know, this thing and that
this
thing.
This guy gets it. He worked in baseball.
You want to make esports really work out? Get Vince McMahon to come over and teach these pros how to give a damn interview.
Yeah.
And then we got it. And then we got it.
Yeah, well, it's a funny thing because most of the pros don't even want to do the interview. They're like, no, I want to just play games. And it's like, no, this is a TV show. We got to. Got to get more of you out there.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, some of our interview days are like that. We have days where the interviews go a little bit better. Anyways, guys, here's how far along we are in our tournament. Okay, we had to shuffle the letters here. This is criminal to the alphabet here. But we have two more days left of the round of 24 before we go into the round of 16. Mm-hmm. I know, you know, we're still wading through the early parts of this tournament, but do remember... we have Flash playing random in this tournament. Mm-hmm. This is one of the craziest things happening in all of esports.
Yeah. I can't wait to see that in the next round. You know, random just criminally underrepresented here.
Yeah. And, you know, if Flash can succeed here, I'm curious to see if we're going to have other players start to try to do this too,
well,
if they can make it work.
It's funny, actually. You know, we talk a lot about Flash, but Bishop actually decided before Flash to switch to random. He almost got through the qualifiers once into ASL. He's an amateur Terran. He's one of the best amateur Terrans. But he was trying it actually before Flash, and his Thunder was so stolen that he came from Thunder to like a clap in the middle of a haystack or something, right? Like no one even cares or knows or remembers. But yeah, I don't think we'll see more after Flash, to be honest. That being said, this is our group today. What are you thinking, Tasis? Who's who here? Who's going to win?
I mean, I've been a Stork fan for most of my life, as you know.
That's
like,
true,
I really,
yeah.
If you're a Protoss player, you've definitely looked up to Stork. He always had very smart builds. He's a slow player like me.
And
I see myself in him.
Yeah, and if you're a Terran player, you've looked down at Stork.
Yes.
down your long nose at his low APM and his DT drops and his carrier builds.
Yes. I think Larva is a real threat here.
Sure.
I think Stork basically nailed it when he said he needs to kind of figure out if, you know, depending on how much he has to face Larva, what he's going to do.
Okay.
But I think Noob is a great player. Rush is very, very strong.
Yeah.
You know, this could be a group where Noob and Rush actually move on. I mean, there's a lot of ways this could end up as far as results go.
Oh, yeah.
I personally am leaning on Larva and Stork.
Okay.
I feel like, you know, since we've been back with StarCraft Remastered and doing ASL, Stork's always looked really good, but he was not the same player from before. You know?
Okay, yeah.
And
yeah,
I'm kind of waiting. Oh, hold on. Okay, this is a good song. First things first, I'm the realest. Good pick. About half the pros, I give a thumbs down on the song they pick up.
Do you know this musical artist?
I feel like I know this song, but I don't know the artist.
Okay.
Now that I use Spotify, I get all sorts of great songs, but I don't feel like I'm actually as familiar with the bands.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Where, like, algorithms just find my stuff, so. Anyways, this is going to be an exciting matcher. Also a good song.
Yeah, not bad.
Yeah,
actually.
You know what? The
know
songs are good today.
Yeah. No, some better picks for sure.
Yeah. I can't understand what
they're
saying.
This one's losing me, but.
Yeah. This sounds like the artist is tumbling down a hill trying to sing his lyrics.
All right.
Okay, he finally hit the bottom. All right, take it off.
I like it now.
No, I'm back.
No, I really
now
like
I'm,
it.
No, I'm pulling back out. I'm going in reverse here.
All right, so you were saying
this sounds like Korean Cookie Monster is singing.
Let's go.
Yeah.
Oh.
Korean Cookie Monster got a band.
Monster, yeah.
Okay. Anyways, we're ready, guys. Larva versus Noob, game one starts now. Let's go.
Season 10. Game 준비 완료. Ring in Bloom에서 게임을 시작합니다.
네, so we're going to have Larva in the bottom left. Much very nice mask upgrade from this season. And top right, we have Noob.
Yes.
If you remember last season, it was we were during the very big early spike of coronavirus here. So there was a huge mask shortage. And Larva wore a homemade mask that looked exactly like a diaper.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, it looked like he had a diaper taped onto his face.
Yes, it really did. In fact, I mean, he has a child. Maybe it was a diaper.
Actually, yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. He has one kid or two.
He has one. Shine has two. They both, of course, pale in comparison to Artosis has four.
Yeah, Artosis' seed is very strong.
So, yeah.
I will fill the earth with my Terran players.
My daughter wants to be a Zerg. Yeah, so you were saying Stork and Larva. I'm excited to see what Larva's going to look like here today. And I'm excited about the group in general. I think it's a great group. I think Noob is a bit underrated. I think he's a very strong Protoss right now. And Rush, I'll talk a lot about Rush when we get to him, but in my opinion, top three Terran right now.
Yeah.
I'll talk a lot about that when we get to him. I don't want to hog up the PVZ talking about my Terran player.
You'll have your time.
I'll wait for my Terran match. So, yeah, Larva versus Noob. Looks like a gateway opener here from Noob. See what Larva wants to do. Looks like hatch first.
One thing about this map, you get a free expansion in the back of your base. There used to be a lot more maps that had this. What is that map called? Blazing?
Bladestorm?
Bladestorm, yeah. That's a map that had that. There were a couple others as well.
Yeah.
But you also, and we should see this factor in here, but there's like these weird structures at the front of your entrance. Where you can basically just make a creep colony there without having to have a hatchery or have other creep over there.
Yeah, yeah. Don't know if that'll come into play this game.
It might. I mean, we'll have to see.
I think it's a little bit more about ZVT than the other matchups, but
that's true. It depends on what the Zerg's
going to go for. Because otherwise, like, just making Marines and Medics would kill Zerg every time on this map.
Right.
If you didn't have that, it would be like the freest win. Or you make like a Vulture and send it across. I would probably do it too.
So we have Noob going for a quick expand off of a gateway. And, you know, this being our first map with the backdoor expansion in the modern era of StarCraft, I'm curious to see how Protosses are going to play it. It's interesting to see them go for the gateway opening here.
Yeah,
I guess there's not much incentive to go forward first, right? There's not a real spot you can cannon rush.
Yeah, no, definitely you're right about that. I don't think there's anywhere for that. Oh, is that going to be where he takes his third? That's kind of interesting. You know, you said the first map with a backdoor expansion, then you made me in the modern era, right? And then you made me think about it for a moment.
Am I wrong?
No, you're mostly right, but I want to point this out, right? Because it seems like back in olden times when we had backdoor expands, it was maps like Bladestorm where it's like it's got a normal ramp and then a back expand, so you're basically completely unbreakable, whereas this is a bit wider.
Correct.
And then the other map that came to mind was Neo Transistor.
Oh, I forgot about that.
It's not exactly a backdoor because it has double ramps going up, right?
Yeah.
So it was like, maybe that's kind of the new way to do it. You can't make things too defendable in StarCraft anymore because it's like too easy at that point. You have to add in some flair with these wider openings.
Yeah.
You know? It seems that way at least.
Yeah, we've had a lot of great maps coming out here. I think the best map so far in modern like modern circumstances in the last 2 years is probably Neo Silphid.
It's a great map.
That's a great map.
I think Polypoid is fantastic also.
Yeah, I'm a fan of Polypoid
really
as well.
I like both those maps. I think they give great games. Yeah, and this map so far, I think, is really interesting. It's given us some good ones. You know, actually, Overwatch 2 I want to throw in. I think Overwatch is just an amazing
map.
Oh,
yeah, I think especially for a one-on-one map, yeah.
Amazing.
Or yeah, two-player map is probably a better way to put it.
Yeah. And actually, another shout-out, Eclipse is a great map.
Yeah.
We're actually, map makers right now, I think, are pretty much killing it.
Well, map makers are what keep an RTS game alive.
Yeah.
You know, because... it's so funny, because when I was a little kid, like, first I started out on Big Game Hunters, right?
Yeah.
Because that was just what was most popular. And then I remember when I wanted to, you know, actually play, like, actual StarCraft, I started on Lost Temple. Mm-hmm. And I remember when I learned more about competitive StarCraft, this is, like, in the first year or two of the game being out, I was blown away that there were people that could play on, like, any map.
Yeah.
You could just give them a map and they could figure it out, because it took me so long as a kid to learn positioning and you know, all the crazy rules about the game.
Yeah.
But now, of course, now that we've got to see the game develop, the maps are what make it because of all the different strategies. Now, real quick here in this game, the Lings are going to get the scout off, and this is, I don't think Zerk got a layer, correct?
No, he's on four hatch at four different bases with regular hatchery tech and a Hydralisk den. So definitely a very different opening here from Larva.
This is a bit unusual in PvZ.
Yeah, especially the four different bases that he has.
Yeah, you know, it's one of the reasons why you don't see this is it's hard enough to cover three bases.
Yeah.
If you get a fourth, especially with a gateway first opening. Mm-hmm. And I mean, we're seeing this happen in real time here. Yeah, the Zealot can chase away the drones. Your mining's interrupted. Mm-hmm. It's why normally we'll see Zerg's go on five or six hatches on three bases.
Mm-hmm. Well, here, I mean, he chose to go insta four base. It is cross map.
Right.
And he skipped lair, right? So that's like extra money he's not really spending. Is he just going to be able to hold this, or is there like a solid punish that noob can do?
Well, I think, I think the punish is actually inbound, is these zealots that are going to come out here with speed. It's a lot of surface area to cover.
Okay, it's so not you connected. Think it's like multi-prong type stuff he has to do here?
Maybe? Yeah, yeah. This is... Okay. Now, I mean, we'll see. I mean, it's possible that Larva just kind of knows exactly how to handle this, but at least from a Protoss perspective, I would look at this and think, okay, you're weak somewhere, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, whenever you see any player, like, you know, when someone expands way too fast against you, you think, okay, that's weird. And then you come out and attack him and win the game. You go, okay, that's why.
But could you look at this because you have that backdoor expand, which doesn't count because you have to go through your main? Is this is really only three locations to defend?
You could, except that...
Not four? Yeah.
Except that I think, it's these are two forward out locations on the outside you got to cover, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Normally the natural kind of covers itself.
Yeah, the natural covers the main. Would these kind of half cover the main, you know?
Yeah, but that's the thing is if it doesn't fully cover it, I mean, you can take it. I see what you're saying. But
the Zealots, like, going in between them to attack the main seems unlikely. So, you know what I mean? It's
I
a hard one.
Yeah.
We haven't seen anything like this here yet, so I'm not sure. But
and I'm kind of waiting to see how much of a threat the Zealots are going to be. One thing about PvZ is that the Zergs really have to take advantage of positioning. You basically want to have your expansions impregnable to Zealots. I don't think these bases are impregnable at all. Now, maybe he just has enough Hydras. I don't know. But if you're getting this many drones and this many bases, I do feel, and we're going to find out in a second here, but it does seem like the Protoss can have some threats on the map here. Oh, wow. This is actually a great hit to catch these overlords like this. Those Hydras cannot save that. And by the way, the goal when you do this, you do want to try to supply block the Zerg.
Mm-hmm.
The Hydras are going to prioritize the Zealots over the Corsairs.
Look at
and
this.
And then that allows you to get some free kills here on the Overlords, and then you end up with this sort of gridlocked growth. Mm-hmm. But for now, this is sort of the classic Bisou style that has, you know, become pretty commonplace. Very hard to do, but he's flying around, he's shooting down Overlords, and the Zealots are causing a threat. They're relocating a lot of the Hydralisks.
Well, it seems like he did pretty damn well with that, right? Like, he killed a bunch of overlords. Well, didn't really get too much done with the Zealots, but...
Well, I think he could have been a little bit more deft moving in there, but...
Did you say daft or deft?
Deft.
I'm like, he was plenty daft, faceless.
So, I mean, I think Protoss has done a good job for the early game, but he's held off everything thus far. And now we're just going to go to the point of the game where the Protoss is going to power up.
needs to get something done, right? Because it is the four base.
He might not be able to.
You don't think so?
We'll see. Like, I mean, basically, it's pretty straightforward for the Protoss from here on. Mm-hmm. Is you want to just power up, get a lot of Dragoons with your army, get some Observers in case of Lurkers, and just start to take fights on the map. Now, do we have a Spire that's been made? I'm actually not sure.
No, there's no Spire. That's kind of why I'm looking at this. It's like, if he doesn't do damage...
If there's no spire, it's
four base larva against two base noob right now. That looks amazing for larva. Look at the supplies. He's already passed him.
Well, storm drops would be great.
Okay.
If they don't get the spire, you're crazy to not just storm drop them the whole game.
Okay.
You know, and drop DTs in there and stuff.
Yeah.
It's hard for Zerg, man. Like, they don't, you know, you can drop a few cheap Protoss units in there and just do so much damage. Mm. And they have to basically be monitoring themselves the entire time. So, the Hydra's back up here. We are going to see a bunch more Dragoons come out, because we don't have that final piece to the army.
Larva is looking so strong right now.
Yes.
Like, he even picked off a High Templar. Another Storm got completely wasted. His supply is gigantic. His economy is already four bases with three gas. Like, this... I mean, from my point of view... This looks so larva favored right now.
Yeah, well, larva is such a good Protoss for Zerg player here. I don't know why there's Templars that are just not with the army here.
I don't know.
You know what I'm saying?
Storm was not so good.
This is like, you need good storms here.
Yeah.
To take this. Okay, so we're gonna have larva try to take a fight here. These are great dodges, by the way. These did not do the damage they needed to do. I think there's still enough zealots and dragoons. Oh, maybe not actually.
It brings up a bit more, and he has a lot more at home as well. Just look at his supply stay up really, really high during this. Looks like he's going to start targeting down maybe some of the goons here instead of fighting the zealots. Really good choice.
Yeah, the dragoons do most of the damage here. They're quite good at fighting hydras if they don't have to take damage from them.
Yeah, and hydras do full damage to the goons, so that's important to mention. They have explosive damage, and goons are large.
So he held there. But again, you know, the goal here for Protoss is to push and take a third base. We're still a little bit of ways away from that, you know?
Yeah. And while he takes a little bit of a supply lead here, look at Larva, right? Like, his macro is not slowing down. Like, he's already droned up to what he needs.
Right.
There's a lot of Hydras coming across the map.
Okay. Zealots and Dragoons continuing to roam around here. He's going to back up. And again, we got to see, like, can you... Sometimes Protoss just die to the Hydras. Like, you just dodge enough storms, and it's like, okay, I'm dead.
Yeah.
I don't think that's the case this time with Noob. And we're going to see this tactic just now executed a lot here, where they snipe the Observer with the Hydras.
Yeah.
Like, Hydras kill Observers so fast. Like, if the player just thinks about the Observer, it literally explodes inside the game.
No, totally.
Yeah.
It's got, like, no health. It's such a silly unit.
Yeah. It's also, its vision isn't that far either.
There's an upgrade for that. No complaining.
Yeah, and you usually want to get that, actually.
Yeah.
But at this phase of the game, you can't. You can't get the upgrade off two bases.
Yeah.
It's like, what are we doing here?
Feels like Protoss is really stifled before three gas.
Yeah, you need a third gas. I have seen games where some people will get the Observers, like if they start to get the Observer speed or the sight range I've seen gotten as well. Both are actually pretty good.
Yeah, they're pretty good upgrades.
But that's only if you get contained on two base with Lurkers, where it's like, oh, I need to, like, do everything now to get out of here and break free.
Well, looks like he's going to try to break three out of here right now. Has the Observer there, not picked off.
Got to be careful with these Zealots, because sometimes the Zealots aren't actually killing Lurkers. They'll just take too much damage from the Lurker shots, and then everything falls apart. Ooh. And this is going to be make or break here for Noob. Noob actually has to have this Nexus stay alive. The Lurkers are going to inch forward, and they're going to start to hit the Nexus, and this is going to force a fight. Now keep in mind, there's two Observers here. If an Overlord gets over here and he shoots that down, it's going to be really bad for Protoss.
Oh God, gets one of them.
There we go.
And gets the other one.
Okay, and now...
Bad goes worse.
Yeah. It's like when bad goes to awful. And this match is kind of like almost like watching two strong men arm wrestling.
But one's stronger.
But one's a little bit stronger, and over time, we're seeing that arm get closer and closer to tipping him over. Now, if Noob can survive this, I don't know that he can, but if he can, we're going to go into late-game PVZ, but it just seems like there's almost just too much here the probes are being pulled. The positioning is definitely better for the Zerg here. And notice how he's targeting those goons down. And he runs back away. Fish the Zealots into the Lurker shots. Eventually target the Archon. And it's like, yeah, there's just not much you can do. The Nexus will surely go down. And it's going to be uphill from there. Also, quietly, a fifth base has been taken to the bottom right. Larva's really playing an S-class game here.
No, it looks amazing watching him play it. It looks so one-sided here.
Yeah.
And it all just started with taking four hatches right away, no lair.
This is one of these matchups where, like, it looks like Zerg is just overpowered.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
It is one of those where it's...
Yeah, you're like, oh, well, if you've never seen the game before, you just say, well, I mean, all the Zerg has to do is make those Hydra things and win, right?
Yeah.
People play this professionally? Are you sure? There's a lot going on, though. Yeah. You can make one unit the whole game? And
pretty much.
You're telling me this other guy has to make, like, every unit possible and has to be perfectly balanced, and then the Observer can just get shot down in the game ends? It's like, yeah.
You should make Oracles to tag those Lurkers, man.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
A, that's
well, they
the
didn't
trick.
Have that technology yet. This is an older game, right?
Yeah,
they didn't have
true.
The Oracles to save themselves from the most annoying part of Protoss.
A race that it was, you know, millennia yeah. old, and it took them 15 years in between Brood War and Legacy of the Void to,
yeah.
to get the Oracles out.
Okay. Again, all Protoss can do now is try to get another base. It's one of the more straightforward ASL games that we could cast for you guys. Mm. Now, is he going to go for it or not? Or yeah, he's going to try to come in here, bait out the storms.
Well, I guess that's what you want to do, right? You want to just continually put the pressure on.
Yeah.
And, you don't want him to, like, max out or something. He might actually kill you.
Right. And it's going to be time to for these Lurkers, I think, to inch forward in a little bit here. Good storms from Noob, though.
Larva continuing to push. Yeah, another nice good storm there.
Okay,
those
that was
are,
a great
those
storm.
Are excellent storms, for sure.
And, you know, sometimes Zerg players will just screw this up.
Yeah.
They get a little bit too eager to, you know, they see the finish line.
Yeah.
And try to just go for it. And
well,
that's
so
when Protosses can back up.
Yeah. That is so much of StarCraft, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's actually really incredibly hard to kill people in this game.
Yeah. In fact, that's a question that we get asked a lot from people trying to learn the game. Is like, I don't understand what I'm trying to. How do I end a game?
This is why I originally said, you know, when you get ahead, get more ahead, because that's just like, you know, it carries over to StarCraft 2, but I'd say it's even more real in StarCraft 1.
Oh yeah, for sure.
It's almost always better to start out your opponent. Well, I mean, obviously there's exceptions to everything, but if you look at this situation, it's like, don't throw everything away.
Right. Yeah.
Be efficient the whole time. Just keep on picking things off.
Okay. GG. And that is exactly why Protoss is Spirit Larva. He's just a very, very strong
He's
player.
He's real good in that matchup.
And that was one of those games where, like, classic Zerg, right? You don't get to leave your base. You don't get to play the game. Like, they just have so much stuff. There's no way to get out there and stretch your limbs.
Yeah.
You know? He just never let the Protoss get to where he needed to be. Bigger, faster, stronger is the way I put it.
Yeah, yeah. Feels like Noob missed something in there against the quick four base play. You were mentioning shuttles. Maybe he could have done some harassment.
I think that, yeah, but I wonder if he missed some macro cycles or something.
Huh.
Like, in theory, you should be able to just move out and fight Hydras.
Okay.
You know?
Even against the four base.
Yeah.
Damn. Well.
It's actually okay to be on two bases and then on four bases. Because you know your third base is coming.
Yeah.
You naturally end up with the extra 400 minerals, you take it. Okay, so Noob in the losers, Larva in the winners. And up next, we've got a PBT, Stork vs. Rush. You don't want to miss it. We'll be right back.
DJ를 하면서 가장 중요하게 생각했던 부분은 울트라 기어의 차별화된 브랜드 메시지를 잘 나타내는 것입니다. 신과 영웅들의 최강의 무기들을 검토하였습니다. 그중 니케의 승리의 날개를 모티브로 지금의 울트라 기어의 로고가 탄생하게 되었습니다. 울트라 기어의 이니셜인 U와 G를 비상하는 날개의 형상으로 레드 색상을 사용하여 강력한 에너지와 힘을 나타내었습니다. 울트라 기어는 최상의 퍼포먼스로 진정한 게임의 즐거움, 승리의 기쁨을 여러분께 선사할 것입니다.
저기 거기 들어와 들어와. 여기. 그 밑에 밑에 개 잡고. 나이스. 나이스.
나이스.
됐어 됐어.
아 미안해 로우나. 화났어?
미안해. 내가 해줄게.
아 잠깐 내가 누르면 안 돼. 아 누르면 안 돼 지금. 아 자 자 자 교표가 무슨 소리야.
좋은 시간 되세요. From the beginning. Hit it, boy.
나 고고 핫식스.
성능을 대용량 배터리로 언제 어디서나 더 오래 즐기다. 72Wh 대용량 배터리 고성능 노트북의 새로운 기준 LG 울트라 기어 듀얼 메모리 듀얼 저장 장치 고성능을 듀얼 업그레이드로 더 오랜 기간 즐기다.
상큼한 복숭아가 사이다를 더 청량하게 새로움을 마시다.
실사 사이다.
What's up, everybody? We're back, and we're going to go to a PVT now. Some StarCraft games do look like the one we just saw.
Yeah, where it's actually like one, many, many of them do.
Yeah, where it's like, okay, Larva's macroing better. It's a game where we really can't tell you what exactly went wrong, but it has to be some mechanical issue, I would say.
I think it might have had to do with just the speed of droning four bases, like put him over the edge on the macro. You know what I mean?
Seems like it. Also, there were Templars that weren't with the army. I think it's possible that there were pylons that were missed somewhere
the
in
there.
The
first two Templar didn't do anything. He lost one and the other storm whiffed.
Yeah.
That's a big deal, too. I mean, all of it adds up.
But, I mean, if you miss a few pylons, like, you have stunted your growth so much. It seems like mostly PVZ is about just getting... First, getting on two bases and not dying, and then getting the entire tech tree, basically, for the matchup.
Yeah.
When you have all of that, and then you're moving around with this big Protoss blob.
That's actually kind of what...
They can kind of bouncer the third base and the fourth base, and maybe push. It depends on the situation, you know?
That actually sounds a bit like Bioconserve right now.
Yeah, I think that there's a lot of similarities, actually, in the two matchups. Anyways, this guy is a man after my own heart. Stork is a great player. He's one of the slower players APM-wise, but... It's his precision. You know, he knows how to control the carriers perfectly. He knows how to get optimal damage with a Reaver. He's got insanely good builds.
Yeah, he's great and all, but did you see the name of his song? Two Steps from Hell, Strength of a Thousand Men. That's the most Protoss song I've ever seen in my whole life. Two Steps from Hell,
I'm glad
Strength of a Thousand
that.
Men. My God. All right. So, I mean, everyone knows Stork, right? But I want to talk about Rush for a second.
Please.
Rush, this is so funny because we came in today and then found out in our pre-production meeting that a lot of Korean fans put Rush as maybe the third best Terran in the world right now. And as soon as they said that, I was like, what? That's literally what I was going to talk about tonight, is that I put him as third right now. Okay? So, in my opinion, I think he's actually a little bit better than Sharp at this point. I think Sharp is much better TVT. I think Rush is a bit better TVP. And I think Rush is considerably better TVZ than Sharp. So whatever you want to balance that as, I think Sharp has one of the best Terran versus Protosses in the entire world. And I think his Terran versus Zerg is very top tier.
By the
way, guys, between those two, I think he's going to get out of this group tasteless.
This is the 1,000th match of ASL. Ooh. We've had 1,000 games.
Nice.
How sick is that?
That's awesome. Here's to 1,000 more.
When we came in here earlier, they said 10,000. We said, no, that can't be right.
Over twice as long as
I always mess up numbers in Korean, like, yeah. Switch them. Like, 10,000, I'm like, how old are we? Am I dead? Are we in heaven and I'm casting there?
Ringing Bloom에서 게임을 시작합니다.
Just ringing blooms. You know?
Yeah.
You hear that bloom ringing? It's like, Tasis, are you on drugs? What did you just say?
Tasis, are you there?
Are you there?
Pick up. It's Bloom.
It's Bloom.
It's your old friend Bloom.
It's Bloom. I'm calling you, or as I like to say, ringing you.
On the telly?
Ringing, Bloom. Can ringing be like you go around in a circle?
No, yeah. I guess not.
Can you?
Be.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe that is what it is.
Maybe that's what...
Or maybe it's just like a high-pitched scream that the flower is making. It's like a flower in pain.
Can I actually just become president of naming maps? I think I can do better than everybody. I think you give me some you send them, you make them, and then I'll name them.
Okay.
Okay.
What would you name?
Well, I mean, it's all the maps. It's like, even Neo Silphid, I'm just like... Like, can you get a map this name? Like, I don't know, something simple. Like, okay, this is Junkyard. This is...
You just want simple names?
I think it's better for the map.
I remember, though.
Like a lot of the CSGO maps, I'm like, these are short.
Yeah.
Simple.
Dust. Dust 2.
Cobble.
Wow,
Dust 2 was the best one. That name was like, wow.
That's when
we're still
I knew
waiting
they
for Dust 3, though. That's the big one.
Italy. These don't sound like particularly good names.
Yeah, these... Well, no, but look. My map names would be better than the CSGO map names. Okay, I'm just saying I think a shorter, stronger name is better.
I want to test you real quick on this.
Yeah.
What would you have... Okay, first off, did you like the map Katrina in its name?
I think it was not a wisely named map.
The foreigners don't watch StarCraft, so who cares?
Yeah, right, yeah.
Okay,
probably not the wisest decision to name a map after a hurricane.
What would you name Neo Silphid?
Neo Silphid? Okay, let me think. Hold on.
It doesn't need to have Neo. Neo is just something that gets added to a map. The original version would have been Silphid, then it would have been called Neo when it got revised.
Okay, hold on. I would just have something plain.
Do you mean like the word plain, like is in the geographical feature?
Yeah, plains or something plains. I would need to... give a little bit more time.
I am going to vote for you being the president of Name and Maps.
Is it okay?
Well, I want to make sure that the game actually dies finally. I'm sick of all the talk of it dying. Let's just get it done.
Like a map like this, I'd name it like Twilight or something like that.
Ooh.
That's my favorite storyline.
Oh, if there were stairs in the studio, I'd throw myself down them right now. Oh, my God.
All right, we'll stick with Ringing Bloom.
Yes!
We'll stick with things that only people who are schizophrenic can understand.
I'm down with Ringing
Bloom. Let's do it, yeah.
Just look, that's what I was thinking when I first saw those Overmind cocoons or whatever. I was like, is that ringing?
Yeah, my mouth started to make the sounds. Is it Ringing Bloom? Ringing Bloom!
Yeah.
Of course! It's perfect! It's perfect! Somebody write it down before I forget it. My genius disappears.
Oh, this has been fun.
So, in this game, we've actually got this eBay being put here. This is a great move to do against a Protoss who's fast expanding.
Yeah, yeah.
It's cheap to cancel the eBay, and it absolutely interferes with the pathing of the probes.
He did end up making a sell odd, so that's all. It's going to go down there and force a cancel much quicker, but Rush doesn't care very much. Now, to mention the actual opening builds, this was Command Center first against Nexus first. Which obviously you have to, like, you can't get a faster Nexus than Nexus first, right?
Yeah.
Whereas with Terran, you almost never go Command Center first because if ever, like, a Zealot comes, you just lose the game instantly.
Right.
So it's a very risky build to pull off in any matchup, but, you know, in any matchup, but he did it and he pulled it off. So this is already, like, really nice, and you can see he's got fantabulous building placement there. Like, you can't even pressure that with goons, right? Because the bunker's in the front. So really nice stuff from Rush. Now, I am kind of surprised. Oh, okay, that was the second factory that just went down then. Yeah. That makes more sense. I was like, why do you have that much gas when that went down? So we'll see what Rush ends up doing. But you definitely feel comfortable against Nexus first with Command Center first. Okay, like... If you go even gasless expand and you run into a Nexus first, you're like, oh, okay, we're pretty much on par. Like, Protoss has a tiny lead, right? Especially when it's the greedy Nexus first. But let's see. It looks like Rush is going to do a macro-oriented build. He's already throwing down his armory. That is an incredibly fast armory. That is insanely fast. So
So he's going to go not for a push right away, right? I mean, you're going to be upgrading and staying back.
Yeah, if you're going to get an armory pre 5 minutes, you're not going to be maxed out. Well, it's command center first, so the timings actually skew a bit. He's not going to be quite maxed out when 2-1 hits if he hits 2-1 perfectly. But since it's command center first, he actually will be a little bit closer. If this was a regular build with this quick of an armory, he would be like maybe 30 supply below max. So, I mean, it could be a 2-1 push, or this could even be setting up for a real big macro game, like a 3-2 push.
Yeah. This is going to be interesting. It is actually a tricky way to play against the Protoss, because, like, if they just stay back and you're defending, they can't do anything. You are getting to play their game, you know. I like this little pylon wall over here early
on. Yeah, that's
really
nice.
This is smart to get out early on and set that stuff up so that...
Absolutely. Pylon walls are like... Anyone who doesn't pylon wall everything they do as Protoss, it just doesn't even make sense.
Oh, no, there's no reason to not.
Just always pylon wall.
Yeah. These areas caged off. Because vultures, basically, if you're not ready ahead of time, you're going to lose to them.
Yeah.
You know, they're fast enough that, like, the Protoss player is able to set up beforehand, but if they don't, the damage is going to be too high. So... we have a Reaver coming here. I'm curious to see if we're going to have shuttle speed.
Dude, this is hilarious what we're looking at. He just went Goliaths before tanks.
Oh, did he?
This is super cool. And the thing is...
Oh, wow. Yeah, I guess you're right. Now, that's funny because, look, like, I think from Stork's perspective, this all makes sense. Like, yeah, you might as well try to Reaver drop. There's not any other way to do damage.
Yeah, yeah.
But then what Rush can just do is blind counter that with Goliaths.
Mm-hmm. Well... Like you got to assume something like that's coming. And look, he's got four Goliaths
before he's
made a tank.
Range.
Yeah, no, that's Goliath range in there, in that spinning armory.
Artosis.
Yeah.
Let's kiss. This is amazing. I love this build.
Yeah, no, this is so well thought out. This is starting to show some of the strengths of Rush. He has all sorts of builds. Like he has the coolest builds and strats. Look at this.
And
that's it.
Oh, my God.
All right.
Look at this.
He is so far ahead. It is insane. So he lost one Goliath, and he has mines everywhere. His third command center started at the similar time as the third Nexus of Stork.
Artosis, he's the chosen one.
Dude, I told you, his TVP is top world. Like
that was, well, I mean, I've just never seen a build like that. I mean, like, I actually wasn't even looking for there to not be a tank. I was kind of watching this game from Stork's perspective because it would never even occur to me to ever skip a tank. Like, it's such a mandatory unit, but I guess because you're on a high ground like this.
Well...
You can't.
TVP nowadays is very much about how much can you delay tanks in siege mode.
Yeah.
Because those are the most expensive things and the least useful things.
Right.
Obviously, that's how you will end up winning the game is through tanks in siege mode. But you want to get both as late as possible. The strongest first upgrade you can get is our vulture upgrades, right? So you can get map presence, you can lay mines down, you can harass,
Makes sense.
Scout everything. The fact that he was able to even make Goliaths and stuff before tanks too, they're just, you know, they're cheaper. And now he's slammed this first thing that occurred. I mean, this looks unbelievably good for Rush.
If I had to make predictions here, I think what might happen is we just have a very strong plus two attack, plus one armor push.
Yeah.
That just smashes the Protoss. The Protoss has will just not have enough carriers in time.
Yeah, he just scanned that it's carrier tech even.
Yeah, so, which is that's like the worst time. It's if they scan it like as the fleet beacon's making, where you're like, oh.
Yeah. Well, all he needs to do right now, Rush, is hit his factories and make sure 2-1 starts, and then rescan for carriers. Because you have to make sure they're actually making them, because that is the only thing that could really throw you off here. But even that, I think he would be fine against. Even if Stork, like, pulled the old switcheroo and went Gateway Man, I think Rush will still roll him with too many Goliaths. So,
but it's pretty straightforward from here. You just scan where the carriers are.
Yeah.
And just, are
sure
they still making? Okay.
See?
And
one is blinking only. So that's already kind of like what? We see that Stork is supply blocked. But, yeah, it's looking very good for Rush after just such a nifty opener.
And, you know, since, you know, we've come back from that drop, I think this game should end in one big fight where Terran wins. I think Rush, like, you know, master strategy planner here, just set everything up perfectly.
Well, this attack he's doing right now, it does feel a little bit early, but maybe it's going to work out. Yeah. Damn.
Yeah, this is... No, especially if you rush into carriers like that and you lost the Reaver, you really don't have anything.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. The, well, one of the reasons why you see oftentimes people go carriers after Reaver is the Reaver can at least keep you safe. You can actually do way more damage with a few good Scarab shots and buy some time, and maybe the Terran overextends.
Yeah.
But, I mean, this is, I think, going to be maybe our most straightforward game of StarCraft in this season of ASL.
Pretty straightforward. You see Storks doing a little Reaver drop here and getting a lot of SCVs, but, like, Rush doesn't care about 16 SCVs right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, well, he's already mined all the minerals he needs to have the army that can go end the game.
Yeah. All right, C-Gemp this base as well. Now, I mean, Stork is... Oh.
Ouch.
Stork is, like, it seems like the game is already over, but he does get a little sneaky from time to time, right, with his carrier builds. Like, sometimes he can lose a lot of bases and still be all right.
Yeah.
Like, look here, right? He just killed a bunch of SCVs with the Reaver, and he's going to clear the army.
Are there not more tanks here? I guess they're just north of this screenshot.
Well, no, he lost a few to the original goons, but he didn't have, like, as many tanks as you would normally have at this time because of the opener.
So I will say Stork actually handled this much better than I expected. Doesn't quite have enough to kill that army off. A lot of times when you're trying to do this balancing act, Zealot speed upgrade gets skipped.
Yes.
You just don't quite have the gas. And
yeah.
The difference between speed Zealots and slow Zealots
if you can
is pretty insane.
Force, as Terran, that's actually something that you're really thinking about. Like, if you have any chance to force a fight before Zealot speed,
oh, yeah.
You'll win it.
Yeah.
You know, it's... It's very useful. All right, so some turrets being made here. He doesn't have that many Goliaths yet, and I think you're right that there's no Zealot speed.
I didn't see the Citadel.
I think the Zealot speed, if he's going to have any chance in this game, is going to be important for sure.
All right, so the first two carriers are going to come out here. He needs to snipe some tanks if he can. Getting a few tank kills is going to be the way that you come back in this game.
Sorry, he's not targeting a carrier. Okay, there he goes.
Yeah.
Yeah, when the carrier count's this small, don't kill interceptors, always target the carrier.
Oh, is that the general rule to always just go?
Yeah, when they have a lot of carriers, it's pointless to target them because they'll just kill stuff and run away. But
yeah.
When there's like a couple of them against low Goliath counts, just target the carrier and you'll just force them away immediately.
So the problem right now is that Protoss is getting squeezed so hard. There's an expansion here that is completely isolated. And it is just a matter of time before it's picked off here. And I don't see Stork lasting.
No.
I don't know how.
It seems like it is unlosable for Rush, but Stork should be on four carriers now, right? Maybe if he, like, do you keep trying to pick this off? Do you try to counterattack and pull up your ramp?
I think for Terran, I think you just fill this area up with turrets. Goliath,
oh, for sure you do.
You just start to take other bases on the map, but it's like...
Yeah, it's incredibly powerful, actually, to build some extra turrets here.
Yeah.
Once you actually have your factories all running, just throw extra minerals into turrets.
Okay, so we have slow lots.
Oh, okay.
Oh, never mind. Okay, they pick up speed.
And he's actually going to clear the tanks. A lot of the tanks, but he's losing carriers up here.
Well, if he can clear the tanks, he might be able to take a kind of wonky ground fight.
Yeah.
Like,
it's a good clear on most of the tanks right there. That's for sure.
Yeah, if he can get rid of this last tank, it doesn't look like Stork's micromanaging that much right now.
He's going to back up and re-nexus here.
This is actually quite similar to our other game. It's just watching the Protoss just not ever quite have enough.
Yeah, but he's fighting pretty well. Like, he's eliminated a lot of units here with only one tank. Like, you can almost fight against this. And look at that. That's some good Reaver micro. Look at that. Gets another Scarab off. How many carries? Does he have three right now, or did he actually lose more than we saw on camera?
I think we might have missed it. GG,
okay.
I think he lost more than we realized. Okay. It's hard to catch everything that's happening at once.
Yeah.
Okay, so Rush wins that, and I think, you know, we could talk about that late game fight, but really what's most impressive is that he skipped tanks, completely blind countered the Reaver play.
Yeah.
I mean, Stork was, I mean, it's completely sensible to try to go for Reavers there. He just straight up shot the shuttle down and outsmarted one of the best strategic players of all time.
Well, his build was amazing. His building placement on key, like, it was a great play from Rush and a strong victory. And that means we have a PvP and a loser match.
Very exciting. Okay, well, Rush moves on, and I cannot wait for this next match. Is this going to be Larva versus Rush?
Yeah, that's going to be good. Rush has amazing TVs.
Yeah, that's going to be very cool to see. Maybe Rush takes it. Larva's looking very strong today. And yeah, with the PvP, I do look forward to that. Who's going to take that, guys? We got a short break. We'll be right back.
What are you doing?
양자택의 밸런스 게임, 더 좋은 걸 선택하세요.
존잘 노잼 vs 전문 유잼.
존잘 노잼? 그냥 존잘로 살고 싶으세요.
존잘 노잼 선택하겠습니다. 잘생기면 다 용서됩니다.
아, 저는 존잘 노잼이 나은 것 같아요.
예상 얼굴이 중요하더라고요.
전 돈못 유잼이요. 얼굴 뜯어먹고 살 거 아니니까.
존잼이면 그냥 가만히 있어도 재밌어요. 경영이 보세요.
존모 유잼이 낫지 않을까. 전 개인적으로 웃긴 사람을 좋아해가지고 약간 좀 매력 있고 약간 그런 것 같아요. 존잘 노잼은 좀 여자들이 싫어할 것 같아요.
여자들이 얼굴만 봐도 웃잖아요. 존잘 노잼 선택할게요.
제 주위에 존모 유잼이 있거든요. 연보성이라고. 술자리에선 그게 나은 것 같아요. 저는 그냥 평소에도 어차피 뭐 잘생긴 사람은 어차피 저 한 명 있어가지고 그래서 존먼 유잼이 좋은 것 같습니다.
소고기 커피 사주기 vs 그 돈 땅에 버리기.
근데 그 돈 땅에 버리기는 뭐죠? 저는 그냥 소고기 커피 그냥 같이 맛있게 먹을 것 같은데. 예.
네. 연락한 프로 게이머면 뭐 당연히 사주는 게 맞지 않나요?
김학수요. 그냥 그 돈 땅 바닥에 버릴게요. 그 친구 상상하기도 싫네요.
최근에 태경이었던 것 같은데 아마도 믿기 힘들겠지만 태경이었어요. 소고기 플러스 커피 사주기죠. 예, 다 요즘 힘듭니다. 돈 땅에 버릴 수가 없어요.
땅에 버리는 거나 걔네한테 버리는 거나 똑같기 때문에 그래도 사주면서 버리는 게 낫죠.
한디열 그럼. 디열이가 오늘 대회 올라가라고 연락을 해줬는데 소고기 플러스 커피 사주기 대 그 돈 땅에 버리기 할 거면 두현이한테 돈 땅에 버리겠습니다.
그냥 경기장 오면서 윤중영이야 연락하고 왔어요. 소고기 플러스 커피 사주기 그 돈 땅에 버리기. 그 돈 땅에 버릴게요.
한 시즌 동안 별풍대전 0승 플러스 개인리그 우승 vs 별풍대전 전승 플러스 개인리그 예선 탈락.
무조건 개인리그 우승을 선택하죠. 개인리그 예선 탈락하면 너무 관심이 없어져요.
별풍대전 0승 개인리그 우승이죠. 무조건. 이건 무조건이에요. 우승하면 2천만 원이잖아요. 2천만 원을 별풍선 몇 개 했다가 우승하면 또 사람들이 얼마나 많이 축하한다고 이렇게 또 도와주시겠어요. 100이면 100이다 이걸로요. 진짜. 아닌 사람도 있다고요? 그 사람은 하루만 사는 사람이에요.
와, 이건 별풍선 포기하라는 거잖아요. 저는 무조건 별풍선입니다. 개인 리그는 너무 낮아요. 우승할 확률이.
별풍대전 전승하겠습니다. 스폰빵 다 이기면은 어느 정도 인정을 해주니까 그래도.
저는 무조건 개인 리그 우승. 저는 좀 명예가 필요해요.
와, 이거는 돈이냐 명예냐인데 별풍대전 전승이요. 먹고 살기에는 그게 더 낫지 않을까 싶은데요.
아무래도 좀 현실적으로 두 번째가 그래도 남는 건 두 번째로 생각하기 때문에 두 번째가 나을 것 같아요. 그거 아무리 이겨봐야 그래도 개인리그 우승 한번 하는 게 나을 것 같은데요. 예, 뭐
그래도 개인리그 우승이죠. 그래도 AS 우승이 그만큼 값지기 때문에 한번 더 해보고 싶습니다. 사람들이 한 번은 인정 안 해주더라고요. 뽀록이라고. 한 번 더 해보고 싶어요.
ASTL 해보니까 확실히 제가 지더라도 팀이 이기면은 그 기쁨이 같이 오더라고요. 그래서 전 팀 우승하기. 팀플 한 번 졌어요.
팀은 중요하지 않아요. 일단 제가 잘 돼야지 팀도 잘 될 확률이 높기 때문에
내가 지면 막 우울해 있고 팀이 이기든 말든 전승하고 팀 꼴찌 알게 승리순서 챙길게요.
울트라 기어로 선명하게 이긴다. LG 울트라 기어 게이밍 모니터.
싱그러운 청귤이 사이다를 더 청량하게. 새로움을 마시다. 실사사이다!
Welcome back, everybody. It's time for the winner's match of ASL. This is going to be a cool one. I'm not sure who's actually going to come out on top here. I am very impressed with Russia's planning.
Yeah.
Today, Larva is just looking like the mechanical god he always has been.
Sure.
And it's going to be on the map Eclipse, which will be really fun. It does seem like Terran, it's not easy for Terran to ever stop Zerg from getting a third base here.
Oh, yeah.
It seems like Zerg just gets a third base, unlike a lot of other maps.
Well, with two hatch play nowadays, you just can't stop the third base.
Yeah.
It's actually impossible. It goes up and you just prevent them from fourth base.
Right.
That's the new against two hatch.
It's funny how this works on certain maps where it's like, it's actually probably too hard to try to end the game this way, so you have to play a longer game. Anyways, Larva vs. Rush starts now. The winner moves on to the round of 16. Season 10. Game 준비 완료.
Eclipse에서 게임을 시작합니다.
Okay, Larva in the top right and Rush in the bottom left.
Yeah. What we're going to be looking for is if Rush gets a gas or not.
Okay.
That's going to kind of tell us everything, or at least a lot about the game.
If he gets a gas first, are we going to have the Goliath build?
Most likely, but 1-1-1 still exists. You can still do it.
Okay.
It's not nearly as good as it. Once upon a time, 1-1-1 was just dominant, and like everyone was doing it every game. But Goliath build is considered better nowadays, but you got to be able to basically do both. Yeah, there's all sorts of. I mean, TVZ is always evolving. All the matchups really are in StarCraft 1. So I'll have a lot to say basically after 12 supply. That's what we're looking for. Okay, so he's going for a wall, but that doesn't tell us still. Like, you can do this with gas or without gas.
Does this just lose to Vorpal?
Actually, I think. If you start your racks right away. Nah, I think it would probably. Because you couldn't get the second depot up. They'd kill it before you could finish.
Yeah.
Like, you could probably if you had both the depots up, you could hold.
Because there's nothing sadder than one Marine trying to defend anything. It's funny because Marines are good units, but you need a bunch.
Yeah.
But like when there's one, right. It's like this unit is terrible.
Four pool would kill this.
Okay.
You are right. I'm remembering now that there was actually a small meta of 4 and 5 pools on Overwatch because everyone was walling on that map.
Okay, so this answers my question. Because when I look at this, I think, wait a minute, is there any kind of, you know, douchey cheese moves you can do to just steal the win?
But you don't have to wall on this map. Like, a lot of Terrans like to wall because then you can do things like skip your bunker.
Right.
And that's amazing.
Well, you also can create a lot more ambiguity about what's going on.
Yeah. And honestly, the bunker and turrets are the same thing as tank and siege in TVP in this matchup. Like, if you can skip bunker and turrets as long as possible, like, the whole matchup, a lot of it, is just trying to get those as late as possible, right? You need to skimp on defense. It's just like your cannons in PvZ, right? You're like, well, how few can I get?
Yeah, I know exactly. Like, if you could actually just make no cannons, it would be perfect.
Yes. Hey, that's a big drone scout, by the way.
It gets
in and sees no gas.
And sees the command center starting here, so.
And you know what? We just saw a scout there from Rush that sees also no gas, and we're already at 2 minutes 40 seconds. So this is a 3-hatch play from Larva. It'll be interesting to see how Rush wants to play against this. There's the 3rd hatch. Yeah, that's really funny because Larva's a little bit known as a three hatcher, right?
Like yeah.
That's kind of his rise to fame and power in a lot of ways. It was in that era, which is like ASL season two.
How old is Larva?
I think he's 25.
25 or something like that. Yeah.
I think he's 25 right now, but
considerably younger than some of the other players that we have here.
Yeah, yeah.
Like I don't have any memory of him being like a big deal in the pre StarCraft 2 days. He kind of when we came back from ASL because I didn't follow StarCraft 1 that closely when we started doing StarCraft 2.
Yeah.
It just kind of swept up all of our time really. But I came back, I thought, this guy's really good, but yeah. I don't remember him from.
I always thought he was overrated because. All the English speaking fans were like, he's so great, and then he lost every match that I saw for like 2 years.
Yeah, but he's a beast.
He's real good. He's real good. Okay, so we just saw the layer timing. Rush has all the info in the whole world, and it looks like he's going for a plus one build. So it should be five racks plus one from Rush. And this build, of course, revolves around trying to deny your opponent from being able to take a third base. It's really funny that this is what we're seeing because three hatch is really off meta. And
yeah.
To see that here and to see plus one five racks, it's like, yeah, I mean, every Terran on Earth can do five racks plus one. You know,
yeah.
It was so important for so long. It's just we don't see three hatch very often.
And so, yeah, I guess now we just got to wait and see if there's any kind of special plans here from Larva.
Yeah.
Yeah, when you're going three hatch, I was on the same page as you. I thought for sure two hatches. That's it.
Well, here, I guess Larva, I don't see a Hydralisk Den yet, so it looks like he will be going Spire. It'll be interesting to see where he places that.
Yeah.
There's good and bad locations because every scan is exactly the size of the hatchery and the creep around it. So, like, generally what'll happen is you'll scan the natural, but there's some meta around where you hide your stuff, right? Like, do you put it on the very edge of creep somewhere? And
yeah.
Because with two scans, you can't always confirm the opening tech of your opponent.
So yeah.
It's like a hilarious thing, but it's real. That's a very quick third base.
Yeah, that's before the Spire's even finished.
Mm.
And this SCV is going to get in here and scout. Well, I guess not. I'm kind of surprised he didn't go up the ramp there. Do you not want to go up the ramp?
He wouldn't be able to because the Lings have speed, so there will be a block. He's
yeah,
just
but
he's
but
trying to keep it alive.
There's no block, though.
Well, the Lings there would
yeah.
catch it. Like, the way he was microing his Lings, they were near the top of the SCV, so
oh,
if
he
tries to go
okay.
up the ramp, he
so he was
runs
actually
front.
Juking out of the way. Okay,
yeah,
got it.
Yeah, there's like little mind game jukes that you do and stuff. Okay, so we have five Raxes on the way. I saw that the Academy was not blinking. You need to get your range out really quickly. Okay, there it is.
Yeah, only one SCV and gas. I didn't know about that with this build.
Yeah, you wanna kind of not overmine gas because it's so mineral heavy to get two SCVs
that makes sense.
And five Marines. Right, that's huge. You have to build a lot of depots to go with that as well. All right, so he is so drone heavy.
Do you make two Marines at a time? When you're doing this, is
that...
Oh,
no. It's one.
Okay, it's yeah, that tight. Okay.
Yeah, it's that tight. You have to spend... Like, every mineral is being accounted for with this build.
Okay, so Terran's beginning to push out. And five racks, Marines, I mean, that's a lot of pressure on the Zerg. You have to be very careful with that. Because
yeah.
this is a number where if, like, you miscontrol, you lose everything.
Yeah. It can be very tough. Larva's going to have to bring his best micro. That should be a Hydralisk Den about to go down. Yeah, there it is. So he needs to get his Hydralisk Den done and get Lurkers up at each location. Other than that, I honestly want to see Sunkens at every location. Like, I want to see Sunkens in the natural and Sunkens at the third, because if he doesn't do that, I think Rush is just going to run him over. This has been such a greedy play from Larva. Like,
okay.
Insanely greedy.
Rush is dashing forward here. The Mutas are trying to take some fights on the side. We see those Sunken Colonies coming down now. I don't know that Rush is going to be able to breach this.
Not yet.
Also, getting them to stim at all is good. Mm-hmm. These medics don't have endless energy. So they're beginning to move up. We have a fourth Sunken Colony inbound here. And the factory is about halfway done. But
yeah.
I don't think Larva dies yet.
No, he's not going to die right now. You see the scans going down. He's checking what the static D looks like. He'll have to reinforce before he tries to bust anything. This isn't enough. And I think Larva has pretty much held him off for now. But, you know, he's bought like 6 sunks so far. that costs quite a bit. So the pressure is doing something for Rush, even if it kind of looks like it's not. Now he has his second group coming up. This could be enough to bust the third.
Okay, now when the armies merge, that's when the threat becomes real here. Mechanically, by the way, on both sides, this is very demanding.
Oh,
I don't know if this can be stopped. Yeah, he's
gonna
go for it.
100%. Oh my god. Yeah, the mutas need to stay right here. The second sun can just finish, and he's gonna start. Wow, okay.
Is he just gonna go for the natural?
He's not gonna go for anything now. He's gonna go into a macro game. It seems like it's really questionable to attack up a small ramp into a third base, even against one or two sunkens when there's that many mutas around.
Yeah, it's also very hard to control marines and medics and make them like all move in unison to a spot.
Yeah, and every Zerg in the world now places their sunkens in such a space that your marines basically have to go up the ramp to shoot them.
Yeah.
You can't shoot. If you can shoot him from the low ground, insta-bust. He would have broken through in seconds, right, if you had him right on the edge, but Larva had him placed real well.
These eggs are perfectly placed, too.
He wouldn't even try to attack those anyways, but...
Oh, you say that. Here we go. He's going to come in now. That was... I'm kind of surprised he went for it.
No, that's... Yeah, I don't even know what was going through his mind right there. But now Larva is going to go and counter with the Mutasum, which is exactly how he needs to play this. From here, it's like Larva should be rushing to Defiler as quickly as possible and using his Mutas over here to slow things. Now, Rush, I mean, his build is on point. This is really well timed out. He should, like, are those going to be dropships? Does he have a science facility?
I don't see the science facility.
Oh, he has it at the natural. Okay, I see.
This has become pretty trendy, though, to just go for the 2 dropships immediately and try to swing the game.
If they still have mutas, I don't like it that early. Like, I think you should get 2 to 4 vessels first. But I think those are vessels being made. But yeah, from here, it's like you have to decide how you want to play as Rush, right? A lot of people ask me, for instance, about mech switches, because that was such a popular thing years ago.
Oh, yeah.
This exact situation would be one where you could mech switch.
Oh, that would be warranted here?
I would not do it. Like, I think Rush is a very good SK Terran player, and he should stay on SK. But this would be a situation where he could, because right now, Larva's on the defense. He can't actually attack for a very long time. He's got to get to Defilers before he can really do anything. And the Defilers will be to get his fourth up. Right? So Rush has all this time to figure out what he wants to do. Busting Larva is not an option. The only real way to bust Larva here would be a mass dropship. And that's, like, purely risky.
It also seems like the position for Zerg on these three bases is pretty tight. Like, I don't see where you easily fly dropships in.
Oh, no, yeah, exactly.
You know what I mean?
It's, like, it's very risky.
Like, can you really get into the main? There's, like, a small, tiny area where, like, maybe you can.
Yeah. It's definitely better here to go 1 or 2 expands for Rush. Make sure that you're nailing your 2-2 upgrades. And just try to slow down the fourth acquisition. That's definitely one of the more important things. Like, a game like this generally revolves around preventing your opponent from taking his fourth gas.
Damn, okay, the mutas are no longer a factor here.
Yeah. Which is, by the way, very important. As the mutas get picked off and go very low, it opens up more opportunity for things like dropship play. Though we do see a lot of Scourge out here. Larva's going to aggressively go after these vessels. Yeah, look at that. Beautiful. He sacks a bunch of Lings and gets both the vessels. Loses a lot of Scourge there doing it, and he is going to lose these Lurkers. So I think overall that was better for Rush. But the idea was there from Larva. You need to reduce vessel counts, and he did that. It's just he sacked too much to do it, I think.
So we do have that third command center coming here. It looks like it's actually about to finish if those SCVs are being transferred. Mm-hmm. And this is a pretty big moment for the Terran to get the third base up. You know, Terran can do a lot with very few bases. But we are going to get to the point now where the tech is going to shift the whole way the game is played here. We have a lot of Defilers coming into play soon.
Yeah.
And when Dark Swarm is out, it's like the matchup I think out of all the matchups, that's the most dramatic shift, is when that spell becomes available.
Yeah, it definitely makes it hard. You really got to lean on your opponent. It becomes a lot about keeping your science vessels alive and just constantly irradiating over and over and over. Like, can you create a situation where there's no Defiler for Dark Swarm?
Okay, and this is the mini game of a classic TVZ, is the Irradiate is cast to kill the Defiler before the Defiler can consume enough flings and blanket the map with Dark Swarm. If Dark Swarm, that cloud is ever cast next to the natural, for instance, there's a very high probability the game's about to end.
Yeah.
And so this is where the Zerg has finally teched into the position where they want to be and is no longer just defending against the Terran.
Mm-hmm.
Now, denying that CC is pretty big, but there's this weird thing that happens in this matchup where it seems like the Zerg is supposed to be growing. When Terran hits this, oh my god!
This is not it.
No! But yeah, suddenly Terran can get map control.
Yeah, you definitely have map control right now. And the thing is, Zerg is looking either for Terran to be really inefficient or to get that fourth base up. When
right.
you have four gases, you can actually go Ultra at that point. With an opener like
and,
this.
And Ultra is kind of the final piece of the puzzle.
Yeah. Ultra Defiler is the ultimate.
Yeah, that's when you're actually beating down the Terran.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a hard position in that phase of the game for the Terran.
Oh, yes.
You know, you're basically trying to do everything in your power to stop the Zerg before they get unleashed as far as that tech goes.
Mm-hmm.
So now we see the first outpost of Dark Swarm set up here as Zerg's going to try to push. Not with very much, by the way.
Yeah. Like, he's trying to bring the fight over here so that he has time to set up his own stuff.
Yeah.
That's kind of the thought process behind a move like this. And
this
hey,
is,
it actually...
This is a lot of kills, actually.
He did all right, yeah. Killed a decent amount of SCVs. But he needs to get his fourth up in mining and secured. And that's the fourth he's chosen to take. Well, he's almost been forced to take because of Rush's, you know, constant pressure. But that's a hard one to hold.
Looks like that vessel is going to go down. He can get one more Dark Swarm over here. No, he cannot. So this is funny, and this is unique to this map, I should say, too. Both the players are growing into the same corner, which is only going to increase tension on that position of the map.
Yeah, it's pretty common. Zerg sometimes will try to sneak a base down to the bottom right because, you know, they're very hard to break when you have Nidus's there.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny.
Oh,
to even...
lurker wall.
Oh, yeah,
not.
Excuse me. It. Really nice.
Yeah, the Hydra's actually melted there. Yeah, it's almost impossible for infantry to kill an egg because of the armor it has. So a lot of times eggs are used to cork entrances.
Look at this. There is a single ultra here. That's not really all that scary.
You need a bunch of lings with them too to really do the damage, but it's going to be taken out. Oh, that's novel. Okay, yeah, take out the scanner.
And he's just kind of trying to do something, but he's going to probably end up losing the fourth base.
I think Rush is actually almost about to win this game.
Yeah, nice play goes down. Ooh, a drop into the main base as well.
That
is a beautiful
great.
Drop.
Really smart move here by Rush. And, you know, it just seems like Larvik kind of can't cover everything. And this is why people are saying that Rush is probably the third best Terran in the world. And I love the Eraser move.
Mm-hmm.
This was like this move of you cast a radiate on your own mechanical unit and then use it as an attack. That I remember when I first saw that like a long time ago. I thought this game is crazy. You know?
Yeah.
There's so much to this
it's
game
crazy.
That can be done.
Look at that! Oh my god! He just massacred the drones. Yeah, Larva has been destroyed with this double drop here.
GG, great game. That was a real tug of war. Between two strong players, but you can see Rush just got to that position. Larvik was broken. And this means Rush advances first.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think a well-deserved victory. Like I was saying, and like apparently the Greens are starting to think, there's an argument to be made that he's the third best Terran in the world. And I think that he showed some of that here today. He knows what to do. His mechanics are there. His micro is there. His decision-making is really strong. But that all being said, Larva decided to go 3-hatch on this map.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's a 3-hatch map, Tasis. I think it's a 2-hatch map for sure.
Well.
And it's a 2-hatch meta. I know that much.
more sure of that now after seeing that game. So, up next, we have the elimination match. It's going to be a PvP noob versus Stork. Now, Stork has, you know, as someone who grew up watching the very early competitive days of esports and StarCraft specifically, you got to remember how strong Stork was. Okay, he's basically, in many players' view, like the fourth best player of all time for periods.
Yeah.
He's just not there now, though. Yeah. Like, he's good. He's
quite strong, but he's not
he's
top of the world.
He's very inconsistent,
strong.
Too.
Yeah.
Like, there was a KSL where he was killing everybody. Yeah. We thought, okay, he's back. And then there's games where he comes back, like some of our ASLs, where he just does not, he's not performing as well as we're used to seeing. So I'm always waiting, you know, as a fan of his to see, okay, are you going to have, is today your day?
Yeah.
And I don't think we really know where he's at because he got beat purely by builds with Rush. I mean, Rush just completely hard countered the Reaver.
Better.
Yeah, it was like, okay, now you lose. Yeah. So let's see what happens. Noob is a great player as well. But before we do that, let's do our interview now with Rush. I almost forgot we were going to have an interview. Our player who is now joining the round of 16, it's Rush. Congrats. He says, thank you. What amazing performance you had today. After that winner's interview,
이라고 느껴졌거든요. 어떤 생각이 좀 드셨나요?
I can see you have a lot of confidence in yourself. What's going on in your head right now?
운영이 흘러가가지고 또 마지막에는
Yeah, everything went according to plan today.
보내서 지우개를 한 건데. 네.
When I sent my drop ships.
끝낼 수 있는 딱 좋은 그런 시기였던 것 같아서 좋아하고 있었습니다.
I actually made a small mistake moving my dropships. I guess we didn't catch that, but it actually allowed him to win the games. It seems like your skills have really developed a lot. And even in the pre-game interview, he said probably now is your time to shine. I think after becoming married, playing in the ASTL, didn't really get that nervous.
긴장을 안 한 것도 있고 그리고 ASTL 때도 이제 같은 팀에 있던 배우 형한테도 많이 배워 가지고 그때
I think I played it about 80% out of 100 in my performance today. I could feel my skills improved a lot. Let's talk about the games against Stork. After the two factories, you skipped tanks, you just went straight into Goliaths. It seemed like a very decisive decision. Were you that sure that Stork was just going to play Reaver? So, if Stork had sent an Observer, I forced him to produce his shuttle first. I think he had a lot of questions about what was happening in that game back there. So you shot down the shuttle harass so straightforwardly. Tell us about that. Yeah, I thought this build is really good. And on the map, Ringing Bloom, it depends on spawn points. In some situations, you have an easy location to defend, and I think my spawn is basically the best position to make that strategy work. So I think I got lucky in that sense. Let's talk about the game against Larva. Let's talk about the Bionic play you used. What's most important with that build is to not make any major mistakes. And just to get as much value out of my army as much as I can. But also using the vessels perfectly in the late game is key too.
그렇지만 시즌 A16강과 이 시즌 10-16강 유영진 선수를
After a while you joined ASL.
굉장히 다를 것 같거든요. 좀 긴장을 하라고 해야 될 것 같죠, 유영진 선수가?
And I guess for a lot of the pro gamers watching you. They probably have all raised their opinions of you. I imagine they're probably pretty nervous to face off against you. Yeah, in the round of 16 group nomination. He's talking about group selections. If you pick me, you better be careful. Any words to your fans? So to my stream, people that watch my channel, I don't have a lot of viewers, but there's always the people that have been supporting me. They were saying, just please make it to the round of 16. I guess his fans were encouraging him. So I hope this is a good chance for me to maybe build my stream and do well in ASL. So I'm going to do my best to do that too. Okay, thank you so much. Congratulations. And yeah, up next, PvP. We'll be right back.
디자인을 하면서 가장 중요하게 생각했던 부분은 울트라 기어의 차별화된 브랜드 메시지를 잘 나타내는 것입니다. 신과 영웅들의 최강의 무기들을 검토하였습니다. 그중 니케의 승리의 날개를 모티브로 지금의 울트라 기어의 로고가 탄생하게 되었습니다. 울트라 기어의 이니셜인 U와 G를 비상하는 날개의 형상으로 레드 색상을 사용하여 강력한 에너지와 힘을 나타내었습니다. 울트라 기어는 최상의 퍼포먼스로 진정한 게임의 즐거움, 승리의 기쁨을 여러분께 선사할 것입니다.
잡아 킬 킬 킬 그림님 힐 힐 그렇지 나 힐 이전설끈 온다 온다 잡아 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 바닥 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 바로 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 From the beginning. Hit it, boys.
나 코고 핫식스
이렇습니다.
이상한데? 이렇게 작아.
너무 안 보이는데?
보이지가 않잖아.
쓸 수
아니
없는데?
저 키워보라고. 고...
성과 17대 화면으로 언제 어디서나 더 크게 즐기다. WQXGA 초고화질의 17대 화면 16대 10 최적의 화면비 고성능 노트북의 새로운 기준 LG 울트라 기어.
청귤이 사이다를 더 청량하게 새로움을 마시다 실사 사이다
울트라 기어로 선명하게 이긴다 LG 울트라 기어 게이밍 모니터
Welcome back fellow gamers We are one of you Fellow kids.
Well, you're one of them, maybe. Not me, Tasis. I'm not.
No,
I hate games.
You're old and weird, but I'm still a kid at heart, Artosis. Yeah.
All right, Stork vs. Noob, PvP Eclipse.
Yeah, this is...
Have you seen a lot of Noob PvP or no?
Not a lot.
No.
I mean, I'm aware of him, but...
Yeah. I would imagine Stork is favored, right?
He's really good at PvP. He's very good at the... the strategy portion, and he's very good with Reaver control. Like, he just gets it.
Is he eating a piece of a towel?
I think he's eating some toilet paper.
Ah, okay.
Got you.
His ID is Noob, I don't know.
There are some players that actually chew gum.
Yeah.
Try to chew. I should actually try that.
I tried.
Does it work at all?
I think it's just a preferential thing. I didn't like it. I tried everything. I'm one of those guys that, like, you could tell me the stupidest idea ever, and I'll play 10 ladder games like that. Like, I remember when I first saw Elky playing.
With glasses, I tried that, too. Yeah. I'm like, maybe I should put these sunglasses on. I'm like, this is terrible.
It was awful.
All right, game 4 is ready on Eclipse. Let's eliminate one of these players.
ASL 시즌 10. 게임 준비 완료. Eclipse에서 게임을 시작합니다.
So we have Stork, bottom left. Noob, top right.
Okay, so nobody sent a probe out right away. Proxying is still really strong PvP. It's good against the other races, but it also will just kill Protoss too. One thing we want to watch for, you know, is if there is going to be any aggressive play here, because one of the harder things to do in the game is keep your probes alive in a PvP. Mm. Probes die really fast.
They do die pretty quick, don't they?
Yeah. I mean, probes are very brittle units. But yeah, for now, we don't see anything going across the map, any cheesy play at all here. The ramp is small, and you do start on high ground, so tech builds are completely fine. I generally say you don't want to do, like, three-gate all-ins on maps where there's a high ground.
Yeah,
but
right?
people do it, man.
Yeah, well, it
there's
seems
a bunch
to
of
be...
boneheads on the ladder just doing that, where, it happens to me, and I'm like, oh, okay, well, I just didn't have my screen ready for that.
Yeah.
So I guess I lose.
Glad that you can feel the pain of playing against Protoss.
Yeah,
as well.
No, it's trust me, man.
Yeah, we saw that, right? Was it last week with Shuttle, where he did the worst DT build ever? Like it was
late
that his opponent was like, "Nah,
I'm gonna take a Nexus.
DTs.
Yeah, it shouldn't be."
And then
that.
He just insta dies like one DT swipe. He's like, "GG."
Yeah, it's funny because. It's one of those things where even I was saying as I was watching, I'm like, well, I don't know why he didn't get gassed that fast. We don't really see this that often. Maybe
it was
there's,
so weird. It was
maybe he wants to have another probe out a little bit more quickly, but I didn't think that's what was more valuable at the time.
Yeah.
It's like, oh.
Well, those mind games can exist in PvP, it seems, right? Where you kind of you do it.
Oh wow.
Mana pylon.
Oh, wow. He actually caught trapped three probes.
You can jump two out, though, pretty easy.
Yeah, but I mean, that's so much.
Yeah. For
damage.
Sure.
Even to get the two out, it's so annoying.
Dude, it's, yeah.
That was actually great.
Do you like attacking the pylon like that? I feel like when you commit Demi to attack, you can cancel the pylon. Oh, I guess he doesn't, though.
Yeah, so, the truth is I'm actually not sure.
I generally
won't attack
with the SCVs until it finishes.
I tend to not mana pylon as much if we're both teching.
Okay.
I probably should, but I just... doesn't happen a lot, so I'm not really sure. I mean, that was a pretty early mana pylon that he pulled off. And that's a lot of interrupted mining. Oh,
nice.
Moving shot down the probe.
Okay, so Stork is... I mean, he's down a supply now since he lost the probe, but... Was that worth it, do you think? Is it always worth it?
Yeah, it's worth it.
It's always?
Well, if he gets three, I mean, that's really good. To
yeah,
force
there
two
probes
to
not
move
mining
on.
For a long time.
Yeah.
Takes eight seconds to mine minerals and bring them back to the Nexus. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
and
I guess
then you have
you look
to, you
at
have
the
to
map
also
there,
think about all the probes that get forced around the back, and it's.
Mm-hmm.
And so.
Mana pyloning is always interesting, I think, to just kind of look at math behind it.
Yeah.
It's kind of similar to SCVs repairing a bunker and things like that.
Well, it's quite strong against. Protoss because, you know, first of all, Dragoons do not fire fast.
Mm.
And, you know, it's just annoying to even have your melee units get over there. And there's a lot of players that flirt with the idea of skipping the Zealot just to get everything accelerated a little bit more quickly, and it's really punishing. If you have a Dragoon making you get Mana Pylon, it's like, ugh.
Yeah.
It's so bad.
On two-player maps, do you ever skip the Zealot, though? Because it feels like it's more likely that you're going to see either a Zealot or a Mana Pylon, because they know right where you are, right?
Well, I mean, you're more afraid of being all in.
Yeah.
You know, with, gates in your base. I don't know if that line of thinking is exactly correct. It seems like that's not you're not getting a Zealot because it's a two-player map. You're trying to get a Zealot to curb a lot of other stuff that can come out.
Okay.
And be safe against, a Mana Pylon, for instance. So this was a little technique Stork was trying to use to see if he could slip a probe in and see what's going on. I think the probe actually got high ground vision.
Yeah, it did.
And this just looks like standard PvP here.
Yeah.
Okay, now I think because I thought he was going to fast expand, but I guess when it gets scouted, he decides to go three gate here.
It looked like that was the idea.
Was it?
It did to me, but kind of interesting from Stork because it seems like he saw the Robo, right? But he still goes with the Observatory. Is that what you want to do if you see a Robo? Feels like Observatory is not, right? It's not as abusive as you can be. If you see a Robo, wouldn't an expansion or Reaver be a bit better? I guess he's going both.
yeah, I think you can still kind of go for both here.
Okay.
I'm actually not sure how these builds are supposed to interact.
Oh, okay.
You know what I mean? Like, I
yeah.
To be completely transparent, builds, I just don't. A lot of times when I see people go three gate observer, I'm kind of like, huh.
Yeah.
Because you know it's so good to have a reaver. I guess you can kind of try to get a surround in on if they're going to try to reaver attack here. It can be hard, but if they go reaver expand, I feel like you don't have a lot of options. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They just have a reaver up. They don't have to go out and attack. They don't want to anyways because they have an expansion.
So you may as well have an observer at that point.
Yeah. But let's see. A lot of PvP is also this mini game of trying to catch the observer in its path.
Yeah.
You'll hear us say this a lot in StarCraft 2, but it's also applicable in StarCraft 1, is keep controlling the robo count, like what's coming out of there, is huge.
Yeah.
Because of shuttles, observers, and reavers are all huge game-changing units. And if you can pick those off or limit the number of whatever they are,
especially gas costs on an observer.
So it's going to be Stork who's going to try to expand first.
Yeah, and I mean, the attack's coming in. He's actually going to scout and see that it is three gate. And, ooh, I mean, there's a lot of goons out there.
Yeah, so it looks like what's actually going to happen is it's going to be noob going three gate and then getting a very late reaver.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's possible that he thought Stork might have been going for a skipped observer, two gate shuttle reaver all in. In which case, maybe the three gate player kind of gets a better angle, has better numbers, and just micros it and wins.
Okay.
But instead, Stork expands, and it seems like Noob wants to bring this game to a place where it's a forced ending one way or the other.
Yeah.
It will all in from here. You know, it's very hard for the Dragoon Reaver player to push the other player who has Dragoon Reaver.
Yeah.
Like, so much of PvP is about positioning. It's kind of about being ready before it's actually happened, right? And the battery's coming down here, and this is something that is, it's very good to have the battery for when the push comes. Because the idea is they want their Reaver to shoot your Reaver.
Yeah.
And if you try to come out there and hit them.
But with two Reavers and a shield battery and defender's advantage, like, and Noob is even attacking to the south with Reavers, which is always notoriously the hardest.
Yeah.
So, like,
okay. So
isn't this, like, he should be all right.
Yeah. So this is this weird minigame where you're both picking up Reavers and dropping them. And so he's going to target down over there. And he actually basically has perfect control here, Stork does.
Wow.
This is what I was talking about, where it's like, this is,
wow.
I think this is actually game here.
That was truly impressive.
Yeah, I mean that.
I felt like he was, because Noob jumped on the shuttle real hard, and then Stork just kept flying it back and forth over the Reavers, and then healing.
Yeah, there's this weird micro thing where you want to have the shuttle sort of do this right left move.
Yeah, because it feels like he might pick it up, but he doesn't.
Yeah, and you're keeping all your options best, because if they're really targeting if they're really targeting the shuttle with their dragoons, that means your Reavers are hitting their dragoons.
Yeah, they're definitely
and
range.
And in their Reaver, it's only one. It will target your your Reavers, but then you have the battery. And so it's sort of like everything covers everything, and that's how you win. And so, yeah, that was actually one of the harder games, I think, for me to cast.
Yeah.
But I think it's because Noob, what he did, didn't make a lot of sense.
Yeah, it didn't feel like it. It felt very, very slow, considering.
And so now we're going to have Stork versus Larva.
All right.
Hell yes.
All right, I'm down. Too bad to see Noob go. I think he's actually quite a strong player. I do like a lot of his PvT and whatnot. But next season, Tasis, maybe.
Next time.
ASL 11.
Sorry, Noob.
Until then, good luck in the Defiler Cups.
Yeah. So last map is going to be on Polypoid. I'm very curious to see what Stork's approach is going to be to Larva, of all players.
Yeah.
Kind of hard on a big map, PvZ. You know, the Zergs get to kind of run free.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. What we're going to get here, because there's only three slots remaining in the round of 24, and one of them is going to go to either Larva or Stork. I don't know who to cheer for, Ertosis. Ooh, it's a hard one. Well, whoever wins, the fans win as well. That's right. Okay, guys, short break. We'll be right back with our final game.
Ultra Gear로 부드럽게 이긴다. LG Ultra Gear 게이밍 모니터. 어?
상큼한 복숭아가 사이다를 더 청량하게. 새로움을 마시다. 실성 사이다.
Every day I'm fighting my emotions with that trust stuff. All the time they tell me I'm too late, I should've cuffed up. Every time I tell them I ain't late, I'm just fucked up. God kinda blessed me in that way, I guess I lucked up. She said, why you always falling back? Cause I get tired of playing games and I ain't calling back. You know that fussing, fighting, arguing and all of that. I can't even do it, that is stupid. Please do not become a nuisance. Here's a dollar, keep the change, man. I don't need your 2 cents. Life got a blueprint, I don't really study though. When it come to family, I want one just like the Huxtables. When it come to money, I just wanna feel comfortable. When it come to women, man, that shit always uncomfortable.
I think you missed the whole point. Yeah. Lately you've been caught up in your old joint. And I was trying to find my way. Feeling like I'ma never make it. It's crazy. And we know you gotta shine better. You gotta shine better. You gotta find better. You searching for forever. You gotta shine better. You gotta shine better.
Play dead. You know, I do like the addition of the, from StarCraft II, the Zerg symbol, the Protoss symbol, and the Terran symbol. We didn't have that before.
No, we did not.
Now we have cool symbols we can zoom in on between our games. It's really enhanced my esports experience.
Yeah, it's nice to have like a some sort of symbol for the race, I guess.
That's cool. I like it.
Okay, which one is the best symbol, though?
Zerg, for sure.
Yeah, I think you're probably right about that.
For sure, easily.
Oh, jeez. Sorry.
Yeah.
You don't like the eagles of Terran?
You're like, Tasis, which one has more edges, a circle or a square? I'm like, Artosis, we shouldn't be recording this right now. All right, so I don't know who takes this. Maybe Larva, but Protoss... When Stark plays Protoss, magic happens. Mm. Okay? And again, our map's Polypoid. Let's get the final player to survive out of Group C. Season 10. Game 준비 완료.
Polypoid에서 게임을 시작합니다.
And the Protoss symbol, look, you could like throw that and kill somebody.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
The Zerg symbol also.
Oh, yeah, the Zerg symbol is absolutely, you could throw it and kill somebody. Mm. Probably cut someone's head off with that. Oh, Terran symbol, it's like...
Look at me, I'm an eagle.
Yeah, look at this, it's a bird, even though we're the humans. It's like, what? What are you doing, you idiot?
Yeah, I think that's the weakest one.
It's not just any bird, it's a dangerous bird. It's like, okay, I get it, you're a hard dude. Don't hurt me.
Oh, that's... You just summed up Terran pretty well right there.
Trying too hard, huh, to be bad.
I tell you, if one thing's true, it's that Terran players would lose to both Zerg players and Protoss players in arm wrestling.
Oh, that's true.
That is a fact.
Yeah. You guys better be really smart.
Wimpy little wrists, faceless with our little carpal from all of our APM to try to stay alive.
You guys would not be the people that make our buildings.
No,
okay?
Certainly not.
That's not true. I don't say we need a bridge built here. Get a couple Terran players over here.
No.
Yeah.
They don't build bridges. They build walls.
Yeah. Okay, so... one thing about this map is it's really big. I don't want to say that's like better for the Zerg, but I think a lot of Protoss players would agree you're a little bit more uncomfortable with the more space they have to take bases and grow and develop. And is Stork actually going to just go Nexus on 11? I actually really like this.
He might, yeah. It looks like it.
This is one of these builds where like it's a very tournament build.
A very tournament build.
Like, okay, I'm actually going to take a risk because, like, we're both basically... It's funny how this works, too, because I know that there's a large number of people that just watch this because they need help with their ladder builds.
This is not where
this
you get that help.
This is not a ladder build.
None of the builds you've seen tonight are ladder builds.
Yeah. And so one of the reasons why you would do this is that the odds of, let's say, somebody like Larva 4-pooling is so low. Because Larva's known to be such a good player, and the stakes are quite high because it's a best of one. And if Stork plays remotely normal, then he will just be killed.
Yeah.
Or Larva will just be killed. But so what Stork does, he just blindly makes a Nexus, and then he made a gateway.
And the gate was on 14, not 11. The Forge one that you talked about, right, is Rain's 11-11. So
I thought it was going to be an 11-11, and it's not.
Yeah, which is, all he did was scout that there was an Overlord there, and was like, you know what, gateway. I don't know how you make decisions like this, but this is next level greed.
Yeah, well,
it's going to work out amazingly.
This is corner cutting to a level I actually haven't casted in a long time.
Well, it feels like to me like it's not just corner cutting; it's pure risk as well, because if it was like Overpool and there were Fourlings that were on the way.
Yeah. Here's...
He'd have been dead, right? Like, that's... He just was like, I don't know, I think it's hatch first.
I don't know the timing of something like this exactly. Mm. But I think, just barely this cannon finishes. And keep in mind how fast the gas is coming because of this. I mean, this is kind of crazy.
Yeah. Well, I mean, looks great to me. Stork should be feeling very good about his opening.
Yeah, and now the cannon's going to finish. And one thing when you do Nexus on 11 is you get to skip a pylon.
Mm, that's always nice.
The Corsair comes out so fast. And, you know, a lot of Zergs don't get to even practice against this.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's not...
Sure.
So this is very, very, very cool to see.
and two Zealots already going across the map. This, yeah. It feels like Stork is doing everything.
Yeah, no, I mean, well, this is beautiful play here. I mean, he just sort of...
This is always something he was known for, is these optimized builds that are amazing.
Yeah. And now he's propelling himself into a great spot in this game. It doesn't mean that, like, Larva's in real hot water, but, I mean, this is... Things are going as well as they possibly could back at home.
Yeah. And now he's going to send his ults. Now this Overlord spots him. He was being a sneaky snake going around the back, but
yeah, this
Larva's going to be ready.
But two Zealots can absolutely fight six Lings.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot of players park two Zealots down there. Seems like a very good place to
hide. He's going to flank it right now, so he's going to be able to clear that. But a probe is going to get a full scout.
Yeah, this is
because he knows that this is going to happen. Damn, he really prepped for this.
Yeah, no, he's so good. And now the probe comes in here and confirms there's not a Hydra all in.
Yeah.
The layers come in here.
He doesn't need another cannon or anything.
No, he's completely fine.
Stork has really done a lot of things this game. He is really playing well today.
I'm going to be surprised if Stork loses this game just by how perfectly everything...
Yeah.
Like, the stars are aligning right now for him.
Really? Like, well, I wonder what could go wrong. Let's try to figure that out for a second, because it looks completely Stork favored at the moment. Not that Larva has done anything wrong in particular. One thing to mention is that Larva does have the Spire on the way, so it looks like a very normal build. Although Larva is one player that almost overuses Mutas in this matchup to his own detriment. I don't think he's going to be doing that here, right? Because he added his fourth hatch already. So I believe that points him more towards Hydra.
Let's see when the Corsair comes in what he's going to map out here. I do like the Spire being thrown all the way down there.
Yeah.
That's smart. It's just
scout as late as possible.
Seconds go a long way for scouting in this game. You know, things are moving, start to move very, very quickly.
All right. Going to end up scouting everything here. It looks like, oh, he stops to kill an Overlord.
Yeah, this is a great catch. The second Corsair is also going to catch that Overlord. Again,
nice.
Everything comes out a little bit faster when you do this build.
Yeah, like this is just timed out better than the Spire, right? So you can kill two Overlords and get home.
Yeah,
or
and that's a lot. So he's going to immediately beeline back out of there. Oh, okay, so he sees that Spire.
Yeah. Well, that's really painful. Throwing out some
no
extra
kidding.
Cannons. Wow, this looks so... he does actually make Mutas.
Okay, I was a little bit surprised by that. I think this is almost counterintuitive, which is why it would probably work against some players.
Hmm.
You know, you're having to figure out what you want to actually commit with where. So he's going to try to actually kill these two Corsairs off. If he does, that's huge. If he doesn't, you're in a weird arms race here, PBZ. I mean, Corsairs are incredible against Mutas.
Yeah.
And, like...
Yeah, he already has four. You can't race him on that.
I don't think so. I don't think
not
so.
Not this game.
I think I get what he's trying to do. Is it's almost like if I was Stork, I'd never expect there to be a Muta all in.
Well,
what's weird is he's got three Mutas, and I don't see.
Yeah, he's got four Scourge, three Mutas right now, I believe. I think he'll stop. Yeah, he's going into Hydra now, but it
so
is.
So this almost looked like it was a fake Muta all in. Like, aha, overmake cannons in your main and.
Yeah, not the end of the world, I guess, in that
regard.
But, I mean, Larva is someone who will go for an actual macro Muta game, too. Not this game.
Yeah,
though.
The problem for Zerg right now is this does set up for Corsair Zealot Harass anyways, so the fancy footwork of Larva is not doing anything.
No.
Like, this army's going to come out here like a hammer.
Yeah, it's a lot of plus one Zealots already.
Yeah. This is a really scary amount. And the positioning back here for some of these bases is not ideal. The Hydras are taking a lot of damage. Plus one's done. Again, remember, the Corsairs prioritize... the Hydras prioritize the Zealots over the Corsairs.
Yeah.
So it's kind of weird to see these. He's going to like let these Zealots slowly get picked off. I think he's looking for any stray Overlords here. I kind of thought he should have just stayed over where the fight was because there's already Overlords there.
There was enough there that it felt like it would have been valuable to kill him.
Yeah. So one DT's out now.
Oh, maybe that's why he went down. Try to sneak the DT in somewhere.
Yeah, you know, if you could get into a position where they're just not... The Overlords are not after the whole scuffle ends, the DT can do a lot. So,
I like the three mutas coming back.
Yeah, it's going to pull the Corsairs away.
Yeah,
he's not
well.
Stopped making Corsairs, so this is not a bad idea. Better to have the muta be killed off back at the Protoss' side of the map than to have these Corsairs, which are really high in number. You're getting to a number where you're actually okay losing one or two Corsairs if you could just kill some Overlords. Okay, this is DT quietly coming in here. Is Larva going to notice right away?
Ooh, that is brutal.
This is really annoying when it actually gets stuck. And he's actually hitting the main here.
Five, six, seven.
Seven kills is a lot.
Yeah, that's a huge amount of damage.
And he might even just go for these Overlords here.
Looks like there might be enough Hydras to push him back for now.
Now, I do think that attack where we saw the Zealots all picked off was seemed to be some kind of big mistake by Stork. Like, eventually you want to run away. There's not really a moment where you're like, okay, I'll just, like, let these fight. Your units are faster, so if you can save them, your number starts getting lower, you should.
That makes sense. His army does look a little bit small for how this game has looked in a lot of ways.
Looks like he's going to catch these two mutas here.
I think Larva won't care too much about those.
No, those are not pivotal in this game here. And I think in a little bit we're going to see Stork burst out on the map. And I think the focal point of this game is probably going to be where the fourth base is being taken.
Okay. I mean, if he can control that high ground, obviously that's gigantic. I love that he made the shuttle, by the way, because he has controlled the air so much. That is such a high-quality Hydra right there.
That's an insane catch. A lot of really good players will have the one DT dropped into the main because you're so busy just trying to protect.
Especially when he just cleared the main of Overlords, right?
Yeah.
Really good stuff. Okay, a Zealot attack coming in at the same time. Oh, the DT actually got left out and goes to the fourth. Kind of
what
a clever
the
play there.
Over here. Oh, he actually, did he have the Templars in the shuttle? Okay, that was the worst storm of the history of the universe. I don't know, Artosis. I feel like there's...
He's not fighting right with his army. Everything else is great.
Yeah, well, there's also a shuttle flying over here. Like, this is a PvP or something. I don't even know what...
He wanted to make sure his Reavers were hitting when it got targeted.
Yeah, now he still might win this fight with good side storms.
And making an Archon still has a good amount of Zealots here. But yeah, the Hydra count is rather high.
Okay, that was not bad, actually.
Yeah.
That one, too. We just need to see the reinforcements coming here. He is killing the Overlords.
He's taking a lot of damage on his Corsairs, though, at the same time.
Yeah, but...
Could that open up a switchback in a Muta?
No, I think he still has too many here. I think there's...
Zero?
He lost all of them?
He lost all of them.
No.
Yes.
Oh, Artosis. How embarrassing.
There's one. I'm sorry.
Chick and mate Artosis.
Oh, damn.
Looks like this one's going down in the history books.
You got me tasteless.
Yeah. No, I think this next wave might be enough. He's going to push in. Yeah, that could trigger him to switch.
Did you see this targeting on the Archon?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know why that's happening?
He's a good gamer.
Because he's going to make me.
Because this guy knows how to game.
Lurker's coming out.
Yeah, I think you're probably right. I think he probably will do something like that. I don't see an Observer with this army.
No. He has a Robo, so, I mean, it's not that far off. I want to see those Mutas fly out, though.
It would make sense to also, you always target the Archon.
Yeah.
It's if you can just pick that off, it makes the fights a lot harder to take. You want me to say that's the Panda Bear guy, Artosis? I know you love that joke. Yeah.
Tasteless
sad! Blah, 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 blah.
No, to this day, people are flaming me when I kill animals on the map.
Okay, so this is all in order here. You lose the Corsairs, Mutas suddenly become a threat again. You can snipe the Templars.
Does he go back into Corsairs, or is he going to rely on Dragoons here?
I think he go Dragoons.
Dragoons.
We have seen some players that'll actually go to Dark Archon.
I like that. We saw that a lot last year.
I like it, and it makes a lot of sense. It's like not expensive. The Dark Archon has utility throughout the game. But I'm getting a little bit worried here because I think that Stork is like looking really, really smart, but actually playing too slow.
It might be, yeah. Well, he's a little bit higher than his normal APM, almost 300 right now.
Oh man, now see, this is where you can just start to lose the games. If they snipe a few Templars, in theory, there should just be so many Hydras that you win the game.
Yeah.
Their army's actually just better than yours.
Every storm is quite crucial.
Yeah.
Picks off that Corsair. It is a big gateway army, though, right? He's got his 1-1 upgrades. But plus 2 here for Larva. He's on 4 bases. He has a lot of lurkers.
Ooh, okay, nice. That's DK. Actually pretty important to control the growth of Zerg on the lower part of the map. Mm-hmm. This map is huge, so especially if you're both sharing the top, the bottom right becomes really accessible for the Zerg.
Kind of interesting location for those Hydras, and it does draw the army out a bit. Looks like Nita's going to go back for some harassment.
Yeah, this is going to bait out some Storms here.
Storms doing more damage to the probes than the Mutas thus far.
Yeah. And
again, painful.
Yeah, this is so annoying, you know?
I do. Mutas killing your workers is never a fun point.
And think
of
how fast probes die with this, too. It's like...
They do that in every matchup.
The Mutas?
Zerg?
Yeah.
They're just like, I don't know, I have these flying units that kill workers really well.
Are these the best units in the game? I think they are. Okay, so the push is going to come out, but we're in the phase of the game where there's a lot of lurkers littering the Zerg side of the map. And it's hard to break that.
Yeah.
Especially because this location's on high ground and the fact that Larva is just assassinating every Templar.
He has lost so many High Templars.
Yeah. No, I think we
You can't attack with this anymore.
No. No, I think that this game is actually close to being over. But let's see if he can't muscle man his way through here. The problem is that the Dragoons are fine against Lurkers, but the Zealots are just going to die. And I think this is sort of a, meh, let's see what I can't do.
All right,
I'm probably screwed anyways.
His angle's really good. He killed a lot of Lurkers so far. Those Zealots are probably getting pretty soft.
Yeah, let's see if he can get any further through here. Normally, if you see the Zealots all attacking into the Lurkers, it's a bad sign.
Yeah, and with this huge flank, he's going to
lose. Okay, that's where the rest
of
his army was. I was wondering. I'm like, damn, is he just going to break him? That actually might just be GG. I don't know if you can really recover from that. I think the counterattack alone may be too much of a threat here.
Yeah, he's going to have to really utilize his high ground advantage, I guess. But that looked rough. He's now 10 supply down on Larva. He lost all of the technicality to his army.
Artosis Stork is going to die.
Yeah.
This is brutal. But I'll tell you what Larva played in A-class PvZ here. He was in a very tough spot with the build that Stork pulled off. Mm. But I think it's Stork's inability to kind of take fights, which seemed to be the problem.
Yeah, his fights were definitely not there, and he lost all the Corsairs, which really stacked up.
Yeah, his Storms were not good enough.
That's one thing I always notice about Rain and Bisou, really the two best Protoss ever, is that their Corsairs never die.
Well, the funny thing when you watch Bisou play is he'll kill so many Overlords.
He'll never sack him. He's never like, here, have all these.
Yeah, he just keeps them alive the whole time. And in that fight, it even seemed like Stork went the wrong way with his Corsairs, too. Mm-hmm. Like, as far as I understand, you kind of want the Corsairs to fight over the Zealots. Because even if you're losing a lot of the Zealots, the Corsairs are killing the Overlords. And then you get that supply gridlock on the Zerg while you're still making more Zealots. You kill off a few, and then you spread them to where the other, especially if you get a cluster of Overlords. It's one of the weird fights you take in the game because you're actually trying to supply block them. There's no other, I think, fight where you're like, oh, this is the part where I supply block you and then I win.
Sometimes a Reaver drop, but that's
about
it.
If you're like, oh, there's four depots here. Yeah,
exactly. Hey, now, is there some chance here that Stork kind of turtles up and...
He will have to go for the long game. And that's a tough one to do on a map that has this many bases
and
this much space. We'll see if he gets a robo support bay. That's usually the signal that the Protoss is going to go for like the late game. But it's hard, man. It's really tricky. You basically have to get shuttle speed. You start putting Reavers everywhere.
Yeah. Well, that sounds like a game that Stork would be good at if he can get there, but it looks like he's going to try to break again. He doesn't have a third gas.
Pretty hard mechanically, too. There's like a lot you got to try to do.
He ran Zealous to the bottom right. There's enough units here to just hold that.
Yeah. Though. Right now, Larva knows he's close to ending this game.
Yeah.
A lot of in the PvZ comes down to that first big push and how it was handled.
Yeah.
And like he just... I mean, this is like exactly how an expert Zerg player plays, you know. Holds off everything, kills off the Hydras, immediately techs into Mutas, kills your Templars, and it's like, you're not going to beat me. Now, Stork is masked up again here. He's still about halfway to being maxed out. You really kind of need to max out army to start to push here.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't even notice his marker. That's here. That's so cute. Funny.
Ooh, Knight is going up. That means Hive Tech is done.
And if you notice, it's like there's doesn't seem like there's any spot that really you want to attack into.
As Protoss here?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I think he doesn't even have the right units to do it anyways. But, I mean, I feel like maybe if he could just get those additional gases up, that would be the way to do it. Does he need to roam to try to do that?
I'm sorry, get the additional gases up?
Yeah, oh. Well, there's no third gas yet for Stork.
Right.
Like, this is like the fourth time he's trying to take a third, but
yeah,
he doesn't have enough units there to ever stop whatever counterattack.
Well, I mean, you're kind of never supposed to let yourself get into this spot, right? I mean, this is like, the Zerg can always try to counterattack and deny that, and meanwhile, keep growing. Mm. And, you know, Protoss sort of has to have their whole army together. You can't fracture off different little parts here. Other than maybe a few speed lots to try to kill a hatchery. And the real scary thing is the fact that this base in the bottom right has been taken. Mm-hmm. Another Evo Chamber coming here. It's like he's just going to finish everything.
Double Defiler Mound, too.
Oh, I'm sorry. Was that two Defiler Mounds? Wow,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah. One thing to note is that, okay, the Lings did just get 1-1, but he was fighting 0-0 Lings against 2-2 Protoss units there. But now that they're 1-1, they definitely counter the whole Protoss army.
Larva's getting to the point where he's going to be maxed out. And that's really the number that shows us how bad it is for Protoss.
Max Zerg is the best in all matchups.
Yes. It is very common for a Zerg to be fighting a Protoss. A Protoss is maxed out, and the Zerg has 110 supply. And it's like, this Zerg will probably win this game.
Yeah, yeah. Generally speaking, in TVZ, if Zerg has 70 supply, you can't kill them.
Yeah, and a lot of the same ideas here. Now, we don't see any signaling that this is going to be the super late game tech with Reavers. And some Korean suits do seem to be resistant to this play.
Yeah, I've noticed that. You know? I definitely have noticed that. It feels like, theoretically, it's the right way to do it.
Like, Best is someone who will start getting Dark Archons and Reavers, but like some of the other Zerg players, we saw this with Snow against Sulky, where I just kept saying, man, I feel like he can't kill the Zerg. There's
that
no way.
Amazing, but yeah.
Yeah, but I think he probably could have won it had he just gotten into that tech that is just so much stronger.
I think maybe Protosses are so afraid of the late game that just as soon as you start going Reavers, that's like the stamp that the game goes on forever.
Yeah, and there's also a lot of people have a theory.
It's like going BCs and TVT.
Yeah, there's a theory that basically you have to try to end the game before Plague.
Mm-hmm.
Because Plague becomes so devastating. I don't know if I agree with it now. I do feel like
Plague is pretty devastating.
It's devastating, but I don't know. I feel like you
I heard your main health doesn't even regen with that phrase.
It does not.
That's crazy.
Yeah, you're just like, oh, so I lost everything.
God, you know I can actually even heal against Plague.
Yeah, your
takes a while,
your
but
race
I can
heal. That's correct.
Wow.
Oh, especially on like your Nexus and all your cannons.
Yeah.
And then the cheapest unit in the game, the Ling, will just like come through there and destroy everything.
You mean the strongest, best unit in the game, right?
Yeah, that is all. Yes, it is.
Which is also the cheapest, which is also Defiler food.
Yes, which also costs only half of one supply.
And works under Darkstorm.
Yeah.
And fuels Darkstorm.
Yeah.
And kills things that are plagued and fuels Plague. Crazy. It scouts the whole map.
Yeah.
And it's the fastest unit?
Yep.
Jeez. The Vulture's not. Okay, shut up.
Hey, Vulture's really, really good, but the Ling is probably the best unit in the game.
It is the best unit. We all know. Followed by the Defiler.
Yeah, somehow Zerg got all the best stuff.
Oh, they got three of the best stuff.
So, yeah, this is where there's this dilemma for Protoss, because every time you try to counter it or try to move across the map, these small counterattacks are devastating. And these are Adrenal Links.
Yeah.
So,
good storm.
He saves that. This Nexus still might end up being killed off if enough Lings come over here.
Oh my god, he just right clicks on it.
Bye!
Adrenal Lings against Protoss buildings.
Oh, it's pretty insane.
It's the craziest thing in the whole game.
Yeah.
Hey, can a Defiler not plague itself?
I don't know. I think it can, right?
You would think.
But I've never even.
I can't think that I've seen it, and that plague was close enough that I question.
Well, plague seems to connect with all targets under it, right?
I think so.
I don't. If yeah, for sure. I've seen plague Zerg units in a game. Yeah.
No. Oh yes, it definitely does that. But I'm saying, can it the plague itself?
I would imagine it could, but I don't know.
3-2 upgrades. Wow.
Yeah. Oops. And again, this is Protoss on four bases barely, and the Zerg just gets the bottom right. I mean, you just get it.
Well, he has one of them right now. Oh, these Plague Dragoons. It's like, what are those ever going to be? Has a decent amount of Archons in there. Good Storms. But he's down like 30 supply right now. And he's being so efficient with his Storms.
No, it's a real uphill fight, man, to try to win a game from here as Protoss. Especially with the tech that he's got. He's still doing the roaming play. Yeah. And look, maybe it's going to work. Actually, I guess not. I guess he just barely doesn't get into that location.
Yeah. Well, at least he's actually running away with a chunk of his army. That's really important.
The problem is, again, it's his supplies here.
Yeah.
Zerg's got 150.
A 40 supply advantage is crazy. Instead, even if they were even in supply, this would be very Zerg favored. But 40 more. Jeez. Kind of funny, we keep seeing Stork running down around that way and then the Zerg countering in the other direction.
Yeah, we're in the Protoss death throes right here. This is basically, this Nexus is going to disappear. I imagine Larva eventually has plans to hit that base in the center left. There it is, GG. And Stork's eliminated, Larva moves on.
All right, well, I mean, Larva is a great addition to that next round. Kind of sad that Stork couldn't make it, though. You know, he is such a big name, like you mentioned, but hasn't reached that tip-top level that we've just seen, of course, Flash always at, and then even Jadon did hit it for a little bit.
Yeah, you know, it's kind of a bummer. I'm hoping that we can see Stork come back and maybe win a championship. But then you look at a game like that, and I mean, it was the execution of the attacks.
Yeah.
It's like the Corsairs weren't where they needed to be. And by the way,
that
Stork
was the real crux of it.
Stork, thinking-wise, put himself in a position where it's like, oh, you're gonna win this game.
If he had those other skills.
If that was Minion there.
Oh, man.
Larva's dead.
Super dead.
But, there's something clunky about the way that he's taking the fights. If you watch Stork streams, he's mechanically just kind of clunkier. Mm-hmm. You know, he's very, very smart, but this is a mechanical game. You need to have very good control. You need to have, you know when to take fights. Like, even when we saw the Zealots get killed off, some of those should have turned around in the first fight.
Yeah. And then just losing all the Corsairs there, eventually sacrificing them was a little bit rough in that second big fight.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, the Mute is killing, like, 8 High Templars. He held on forever with, like, having lost that much.
Yeah, it's oh, well.
Oh, well.
Indeed. We're going to have an interview now with our winner. Only 2 more slots remaining in the round of 16. Our second player from Group C joins us. It's Larva. Congratulations. He says thank you. So you managed to advance in the round of 16. How do you feel? Hey, this is a tough series. Even that last match. I probably could have won easier. Anyways, it ended up being tough for me. When did you feel there was a moment where you were going to win? Seems like you killed several Corsairs and managed to stabilize and get the upper hand. Well, yeah, somehow there was a lot of back and forth in that game. I thought I was behind for a good amount of that game. I definitely had to fight to win. Yeah, you managed to take out most of his army with your Hydras. Well, throughout the game, I thought there were points where I had an upper hand. But Stork's movement, he was very active on the map. I just had to try to figure out how to get a situation where I was in an advantage. Let's talk about the games against Noob. You went heavy into Hydralisk production. Well, in terms of preparation, I really had a hard time figuring out how to play on that map. I tried to fake him out a little bit.
승자전에서는 그래도 좀 아쉬움이 남으셨을 것 같은데 이 3회철이
패치고 When I overlord was killed by his corsairs.
했는데 쉽지는 않았어요.
Other than that, I was just pretty much satisfied with everything.
원래 유영진 선수한테 저번에 한번 또 떨어져 가지고 이번에
Let's talk about the game against Rush.
생각을 했었는데 너무 잘하더라고요.
Rush has limited me in the past. So I had a different mindset coming into this.
네.
I really wanted to beat him today.
이겨야 될 것 같아요.
김홍규 선수 방금 전에도 이제부터 좀 고생이 시작되는 것 같다라고 말씀을 하셨는데
I kind of hit a wall. I just wasn't able to, 그러니까 to do it. I hope I get revenge on him next time.
어떤 종족의 선수들을 좀 만나야 될 것 같다라는 느낌이 드세요?
종족은 so because of that, 크게 개의치는 않는데 이번 시즌은 그래도 약간 좀 프로토스
Who do you want to meet in the round of 16? I don't really care.
가지고 있는 프로토스들이 많아서 네. 조심해야 될 것 같습니다.
과연 이몽규
선수
이번 번째 시즌 어디까지
I guess especially for Protoss players, he says.
보겠습니다. 팬들에게 한마디 부탁드립니다.
We're gonna keep supporting you. Any words to your fans?
뭐 일단 응원해 주셔서 너무 감사하고요. 제가
First of all, thank you to my fans for their support.
바꿨는데 그거를 이제 또 뒤집을 수 있는 또
Because of personal issues, I've switched my schedule around a little bit.
노력해 보겠습니다.
네, 다시 한번 16강 진출 축하드립니다, 이몽규 선수.
I'm going to put all my effort and all my heart and soul into trying to continue to prep for ASL. So please keep supporting me. Sick. I'm a fan of Larva too, man. He's good.
Yeah, no, he's great.
He's very popular out here in Korea.
Yeah, he's one of the streamer. Biggest streamers.
Yeah,
sure. Well, kind of a one-sided group in a lot of these games today. But I'm pretty happy with who ended up going through. I'm really happy to see Rush advance this season.
Yeah, I think today was not our most exciting games.
Yeah. Look at that, round of 16.
We've got two more slots to fill here for the round of 16. And we're going to be going to that on Tuesday.
Yeah, all right.
Are we starting early on Tuesday?
I don't know. I don't think so.
We are not starting early. Okay, production, no. Let me know.
I think they'll probably just have group selection on like Sunday.
That makes sense.
Yeah, that would make more sense. Okay, well, I'm excited for it, Tasteless. Who's in that next group?
Let's find out. It's Sharp, Beast, Action, and Free.
That'll be interesting. Free was always a good Protoss vs. Zerg sniper, even.
Yeah.
And that's an interesting group for Sharp, because I think that his TVZ is his weakest matchup. He's good enough that he can beat these guys, but it's almost kind of a hard group for him. I would favor him against Free, but against Action, I think it's tough. Against Beast, maybe 50-50.
I have to imagine Action gets out.
Yeah, right? That's kind
of
what I'm...
too much of a monster. Yeah.
I think I'm leaning Action Sharp.
Okay.
But I could see Sharp having a tough night, possibly.
And again, in the round of 16, we are going to have flashes random.
Yes.
That's the big story of this tournament.
That's the moment everyone's waiting for.
I'm ready. Are you ready?
Oh my god, I just want it so badly.
All right, guys, well, that's all time we have. That's been our show.
Yeah. Yeah, it felt very fast tonight.
It did. What time is it? About 2 hours 50 minutes.
Okay.
15 minutes.
Yeah. Don't forget there was 1 minute of break time tonight as well.
Our commercials are so short, man.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. Whereas in GSL, we have one break that's 11 minutes
yeah.
each episode. It's kind of weird. But guys, hope that you enjoyed. Make sure you spread the word about ASL. That it is back. It's going to get more and more exciting, especially in the next round, because we start mixing in best of threes.
Right.
All elimination matches will be best of threes. Also, Flash will be playing random. So those are kind of the big... Like for Flash to get knocked out
really
of here,
picks up.
Yeah, he has to lose at least 3 games to get knocked out. So that's exciting.
Yeah, I can't wait. It's gonna be super cool. And of course, on this same YouTube channel, if you're watching us live, GSL is on every Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. and every Saturday at 1 p.m.
Yeah, we just had the group selection.
Right.
And there's some sick groups in there. Can't wait for the Parting Beyond rematch. Hopefully we get it. They're in the same group again. Yeah, it's a really cool season with Byun being back.
Yeah.
And Zaun, the new Protoss.
The next couple weeks are going to be very good for StarCraft. We've got a lot of great content for you guys.
Yeah. Basically, September and October this year are the 2 months where we have like tons of ASL, tons of GSL. It's just never ending.
Right.
So just stay right on that YouTube channel. I know there's like really enticing links on the right.
Yeah, you're like, oh,
don't bother.
These videos speak to me.
Yeah,
because YouTube stalks me and knows all my information.
Yeah,
stay with us.
Do it.
Do it. Guess we can't close the show out yet.
No.
Gotta wait.
What you got planned for tomorrow, Tasis?
Tomorrow's Monday, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Streaming.
Oh, me too.
Come hang out on our streams.
Yeah. We'll be playing Brood War. Less good than these guys.
But, yeah, I'm still trying to get A. I'm
you're close.
Close.
You're
I'm close.
Close. Yeah.
It is very rewarding to see yourself improve. Like as the points go up, you're like, okay.
Yeah.
Because there's definitely days where I'm like, I don't even know if I can learn.
Yeah.
You know, StarCraft's very hard.
Yeah. You're kind of like a nervous Diglett. We know your head can get above the dirt, but like you're not there yet.
I'm not there yet. I'm trying to hatch into A rank, but
yeah,
I'll get there eventually. Yeah. And from there, then I got to try S, but that's going to be. S is hard. Congratulations on getting S, by the way.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, can't wait to get on and play some more tomorrow. Weekends, I don't ever really have time to play StarCraft. I just cast it. Because normally we have casts on Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah, and no, the only times I'm playing is when I'm streaming now. I'm not, you know what I'm saying?
Do you have like five kids? Because even I normally find some
time.
No,
I'm trying to move, so I've been apartment hunting
yeah,
a lot. I just don't have any time, but yeah. Trying to monetize the
no excuse.
How dare you, Tasteless? but yeah, hang out with us on our streams. We're just still on camera, Artosis. Yeah. They just Greencasters had a lot to say about these pretty average games today.
Yeah, they were pretty average. I like that Rush showed some of the brilliance that
yeah.
you get to see if you watch his stream on Afrika TV. He's amazing. He's definitely a Terran player that's really fun to watch. But he's one of the ones that you watch him, and he's not going to help you in your ladder matches as much. Because he has builds that like
yeah.
you'll try to do, and unless you're basically at like 2,400 MMR or more, your opponent literally won't know how to react, which is built into his builds.
Yeah.
So he's like, a lot of the ways that he plays is him assuming his opponent's really good. So not necessarily someone you want to watch to improve, but damn if it isn't entertaining. This guy is so good.
It's exciting to have people that are newer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, I think there's way too much fanfare for just the old school greats, and I get it, but like, honestly, the fact that the game is this old, this is the oldest competitive game that is played at this level. Okay, and this is actually played at a level that, you know, other games that have been out for a long time, they can't match it, but
yeah.
you need new people, you need younger people.
There's a good crop of young yeah. up-and-comers.
It's very cool. Finally, we can wrap it up, guys. Thanks for joining us. We love you. Stay safe. We will see you on Tuesday. Don't kill my vibe.